most celebrated rivalry in college football. It's the Harvard Crimson and the Yale Bulldogs in the 123rd edition of The Game.
48 degrees on this late fall afternoon on the banks of the River Charles. Harvard and Yale getting ready to play one another for the 123rd time. And as play begins on this Saturday afternoon, the final Saturday of the season, Princeton and Yale tied for first place. Yale wins today. They finish in a tie for first no matter what. Should Harvard beat Yale and Dartmouth beat Princeton, there could be a three-way tie for first place at the end of the day. Hi again, everybody. I'm Charlie Steiner. And as you know, Harvard and Yale, one of the great rivalries in all of sports. And while Yale has won 14 more games in its history over Harvard, over the last 5 years, Harvard has won every single game. So they've got a big streak coming in. One of the reasons over the last 3 years has been the outstanding running of Clifton Dawson, playing in his final game for the Crimson. And we're joined by Crimson graduate, class of 76, our friend Dan Jiggins. Tell us all about Clifton Dawson.
He's an All-American running back, the leading rusher in the history of the Ivy League. And here's a running back with soft hands coming out of the backfield, so he helps you in the passing game. And then when you want to put the football under his arm and tell him to tuck it and run, he can go get it. And everything around the offense really kind of revolves around Clifton Dawson. And there you see him running in and punching into the end zone. He's everything you could ask for in a running back. Now you say, well, what about the defense? Well, the guy on defense that we want to look at is Michael Berg. Down that defensive front, he is one of the fastest guys on this team. Runs a 4.640 as a defensive lineman. It tells you a lot about what kind of football you're going to see out of him today.
And so Clifton Dawson is the all-time leading running back in Ivy League history. But this year, Mike McLeod, the sophomore running back from Yale, leads the Ivy League. And we're joined by our friend Brian Dowling, the all-time great quarterback from Yale, class of 69. Tell us about Mike McLeod.
Well, in addition to leading the league in rushing, he's rushed for more than 100 yards the last 8 games. So he's really the key. Same type of runner as Dawson, slasher, built low to the ground, but quickness and speed. The other keys for Yale today will be the twin linebacker and safety, the Hebert twins from Acton, Mass. They could play a real big role today.
Bobby Hebert and Larry Hebert, they are the brothers, and they are getting ready to play. It's Harvard and Yale, the 123rd rendition, coming up next from Harvard Stadium. It's a beautiful Saturday afternoon here just outside Boston in Cambridge, Massachusetts at the historic Harvard Stadium. We're getting ready for the 123rd playing of the Harvard Crimson and the Bulldogs from Yale. And our fourth member of the broadcast crew will be downstairs. Best seats in the house, Candace Kruger. Candace?
That's right, Charlie. You know, not since the year 2000 have the Yale Bulldogs earned the bragging rights in this storied rivalry, which means that this year's outgoing seniors have yet to beat Harvard. Now, head coach Jackson Leggy has said that last weekend's first half against Princeton was the best football his team has played all season. They racked up 355 yards of total offense and scored in 4 consecutive possessions. Quarterback Matt Paulhemus told me he believes if his team can duplicate that first half of play for 2 halves today, they'll be able to get the win they want and the win their seniors have been waiting for.
Well, that was the good news last week for Harvard, or rather for Yale, and they got off to the great start. But Brian, in the second half, they came undone.
Yeah, the bad news is they came at the short end of the score, and one of the problems they've had this year is they've been outscored in the second half for the whole season. So that doesn't bode well for today.
And Dan, that was the second half. Game last year, Dan.
Exactly.
Harvard came from behind in the second half, and then, of course, won it in triple overtime.
So you know what that means. Get ready for another triple overtime today, my friends.
Well, they didn't install the light, so I don't know.
Well, get the cars out here again.
That's right.
Well, You remember last year, of course, we played that triple overtime game. And so we were wondering the last couple of days walking around Harvard, would we have been able to play a fourth overtime? There was discussion apparently in the press box last year, unbeknownst to us until this year, that there probably would not have been a fourth overtime. We would have actually ended in another 29-29 tie, sort of.
29-29 win.
Depending on one's perspective, of course.
Yeah, and unfortunately with the Yale Bowl, you couldn't pull a Bagger Vance and pull up the cars and turn on the headlights.
That's exactly right.
Which is about where we were last year.
I tell you what, though, these games like the one we had last year and the one that I'm expecting today are a big part of the lure of what this competition is all about. And see the two captains out there now, flipping the coin. And there's nothing like that feeling when you walk out for this game and that coin flip. It is something very, very special. It's something you never forget.
Also, I think anybody who's ever broadcast Ivy football knows that they don't really don't care about starting exactly on time.
Well, it's a thing, you know, it's kind of like around that time.
Give or take. Now you guys are both Ivy Leaguers. Didn't they have a course here like in
time management?
Clock.
Here's the old saying, if you're that important, they'll wait for you.
Well, the professors didn't. They started on time.
That's right.
Well, here's Yale, and they have not won an Ivy League championship since 1999. If they win today, they're guaranteed at least to share with Princeton. Should Harvard win today, and Princeton loses, but Dartmouth is playing at Princeton. Dartmouth is 2-7, and Princeton is playing so well. Harvard can muscle into a three-way tie. So a lot at stake above and beyond the bragging rights to these two great institutions. 123rd time they're playing one another.
It's a great thing to have it go all the way down to this wire, too, to have that kind of competition within the conference to... you're waiting so long to find out who's going to win this thing.
55-year-old Jack Sedlecki in his 10th year at Yale. 10 games over 500, but 3-6 against Harvard. And Tim Murphy, the 49-year-old 13th year head coach at Harvard. He's 12 games over 500. 32 games over 500. 80-48 and 8-4 against Yale. Standing deep is Neil Sherlock and Stephen Williams. And so we are ready to go. End over end kick. And from the 10-yard line. Chang Ho nearly busted it open.
One of the hardest things to teach return men is to run the football up the field, straight up the field, and that's what Ho did that time, and obviously got good yards to the 35.
So here we go. Liam O'Hagan, who missed the first five games of the season, is the quarterback. Clifton Dawson in the backfield. And we are ready to play. Trips to the right for Harvard. Dawson the single back, and O'Hagan from the shotgun. First play from scrimmage in the 123rd game between these two teams. O'Hagan with the pass, and a pretty one-handed catch by Alex Bro wrestled out of bounds. And let's take a look now at the starting offensive line for Harvard, which averages 292 pounds. Mazza is, of course, the great wide receiver. He and Matt Luff-Farbatko is the tight end. Now to the big offensive line. Averaging 292. So we're ready on second down and about 6 yards to go. Here's O'Hagan passing a second time and batted down by Kirk Porter, big number 93. Now let's take a look at the defense for Yale. Up front, averaging 245 pounds, Sponheyer, Porter, Hollander, Hamilton, Hawari. They play a 5-2. With Barry and Abair, the linebackers. And in the secondary for Yale, three sophomores and a freshman. And so Harvard thinks they can exploit the youngsters. On third down and 6, two tight ends. And here's O'Hagan running out of trouble and running out of bounds. But a good job by the Yale defense which statistically ranks dead last in the Ivy League. But they show up in the first series of the day.
And one of the things that Liam has to think about here is throwing the football once he gets outside the box. Let the football go. You're taking about a 10-yard loss here when you slide out of bounds with that ball in your hand. You got to put it over to the sideline.
And so on fourth down, Matt Schindel, who's averaging about 39 yards per punt. And Chandler Henley is standing back at his own 35. So here's the first punt of the afternoon. Henley with the fair catch at the 41. And so the Harvard offense goes nowhere in its first series. And now here come the Bulldogs. Matt Schindel does a nice job. Matt Polemus is the real X factor in this game because, Brian, he has the ability to scramble.
Well, he's got to work the play action with the effectiveness of McLeod running, but also he's a threat to run himself.
And so here's the first play of the game for Yale. McLeod, the single setback, sophomore from New Britain, Connecticut. And here's Polemus, and he's got some room down the sideline. And wrestled out of bounds at the 40-yard line of Harvard by Doug Hewlett. Now let's meet the starting offense for the Bulldogs. Wright and Henley, excellent wideouts, and we talked about Mike McLeod, the leading running back in the Ivy League this year. Up front, the Yale protectors average about 283 pounds. Ed McCarthy, left tackle, is especially good. Henley and Shooter are the wide receivers flanked to the bottom of your screen. Out of the I formation, and here's the first time we see McLeod, and he gets about a yard. Now let's meet the defense for the Crimson. They play the conventional 4-3. Bagdus and Curtis and Berg and Brenton Bryant. Michael Berg, six sacks, an especially good player. Ryan Tully, the team captain, the strong side linebacker, the secondary of Barry and Tanner and Hewlett and Williams. So on second down and 9. Here's McLeod again. Left tackle, gains a couple. It'll be third and long.
You know, that first play with the bootleg, it shows you how much respect Harvard's defense has for McLeod because they all went
collapsed
for the fake.
In, right.
And that's going to help him later in the game. Those backside defensive linemen have to stay home.
When Ryan Tully, the captain, got stuck inside, one thing you have to remember on this defense is to box the corner, because if you don't box that corner, then that's obviously an opportunity for the quarterback or running back to get out to the edge.
Hanley and Shooter, the flankers down to the bottom of your screen on third down and about 7. Polemus, the throw is complete to Henley, and he's got a first down and a fumble. Flag on the play. Harvard's got the ball at the 25. Let's see what this flag is all about. Will it save Yale's bacon or not?
You see this more and more in football now. Maybe the first guy coming in makes the stop. The second guy comes in looking for the strip. And this looks like a case where it may have happened just that way.
Yeah, the flag was just the marker, the change position.
So Harvard takes over on the turnover.
And again, watch as the defenders come in trying to strip the football. This is what they do a lot of, punching that football out of there, pulling it out, and going after it, and certainly makes for some turnovers.
Glenn Doris with the fumble recovery, and turnovers were just killing Yale all last year. Here's Clifton Dawson's first run from scrimmage, and he loses about 5 as Brant Hollander, the interior guard for the Bulldogs, wrestles him down.
And again, it's a slashing defense, and he just gets across, gets great penetration there. He's in the backfield. He could have taken the handoff.
Well, I think their Yale's defense is really showing the pride they have, because Harvard's defense is the one that's been
ranked number one in the nation and stopping the run.
And so Dawson loses 5. He averages 5.5 yards per carry. On second down, here's Dawson, net in the backfield, another loss of 5. That was the defensive end Brendan Sponheimer with the tackle.
And Charlie, Brendan is the son of John Sponheimer, who was a defensive tackle at Cornell in the late 60s. played against a little bit. So he's carrying on the tradition of his dad.
Yeah, he met this one out on the corner and met it well, too. One of the things I'm going to be fascinated to follow today is the little extras after the tackles and whatnot. I'm going to wait and see how that all happened, all that kind of plays out today.
The Harvard offense minus 21 yards so far this afternoon. Third and a long way to go, 21. The pass is complete to Matt Luff, and he barely gets to the 20, and he's gang tackled. And the Yale defense, much maligned through the course of the season, has come up big in the first two series.
Active, getting after people, getting across the line of scrimmage, disrupting the offense. That's exactly what they're doing.
And as everybody can see, this is the first game that the two teams have played on artificial surface. And with the rain, all the rain that we had this week, the footing is very good.
Matt Schindel's first punt, 30 yards, and this one doesn't seem to be a whole lot further. The fair catch by Henley at the 50-yard line, and we're going to take a break. So far, the early story has been a surprising one. The Yale defense holding Harvard to negative yardage.
You can make it if you try. You can make it if you try. You can make it if you try. Oh, yeah.
You kind of just get that feeling when you got a day like this and everything comes together. It's a Yale kind of day.
It sure is.
I played for Harvard 50 years ago. They're going to win today. It's great to be here. It's good fun.
That I just left some Michigan alums who were saying Harvard plays football. And I said, well, you're going to the Michigan game, right? And he said, that's right. And I said, well, aren't those all the guys who couldn't get into Harvard and Yale?
Well, Yale is off to a lousy millennium against Harvard in this great rivalry. Harvard has won five games in a row. If Yale wins today, they earn at least a portion of the Ivy League championship for the first time since 1999. Their second series, outstanding field position. And here's Mike McLeod, and he gets nothing and probably loses a yard as Daniel Tanner comes up from the strong safety position to make the tackle.
This is what we talked about earlier, Yale leading the league in rushing and Harvard defense leading the league against the rush. So we're going to see who bends first.
Well, both sides have been bending so far.
So far, neither running back is distinguished himself.
Here's Matt Palamas, the junior from Chatham, Massachusetts. Second and long. Palamas has found his receiver, Langston Johnson, the tight end. And he's all the way down to the Harvard 31 and a first down. Doug Hewlett, the weak side safety, made the tackle.
I think you're going to see a lot of misdirection today with the respect that these two tailbacks have.
Mm-hmm. And the play action off of the misdirection is something that's going to be wide open because the defense is pursuing so quickly to the football.
So Langston Johnson with just his third reception of the season. They pick up 20 on the play. From the eye on first and 10. Palamas holds on, throws long, incomplete, intended for Chandler Henley, but flags fly, and that'll be interference.
What happened on the play up front is Michael Berg had an opportunity to rush the passer, slipped, fell, got back up, got into the quarterback's face. By the time he got back up, that ball was just leaving the quarterback's hands, and the receiver was wide open going to the zone.
Pass interference on the defense, number 4. Penalized 15 yards, automatic first down.
Number 4 is Andrew Berry. But really, it was number 2, Stephen Williams.
Andrew Berry was a victim of vicinity.
Dan, what do you think of the new pass interference rule as opposed to the spot of the foul to 15 yards. That's fair?
I don't. You know, anything that hurts an offense, I'm not going to think is fair.
I guess, yeah, I agree with you.
On first down, McLeod on second effort gets to about the 16-yard line. The weak side linebacker, Eric Schultz, made the tackle.
There was an example there of boxing the corner, closing down the trap. There was a trap play on, and you can see the right guard come across and try to get that defensive lineman or the corner out of that area. And they made him turn it up, and as a result, there were about three or four defenders waiting for him. Here again is the look. You see 64 right there coming through in the trap, closes down the play, and then the remainder of the defense is inside.
Second and nine. McLeod up the middle to the 5-yard line, and a first and goal. So downstairs, Candace Krueger.
Well, Charlie, quarterback Matt Palhemas told me last weekend's loss to Princeton that snapped their 7-game winning streak didn't shake the Bulldogs' confidence, but he said it was a real wake-up call. He said they're ready to redeem themselves today.
Well, Yale, again, they haven't beaten Harvard in the last 5 meetings, and if they win today, their first Ivy League title will probably share it with Princeton playing at home against Dartmouth. There's McLeod again, but he's wrestled down at about the 3-yard line. That's Eric Schultz again, a very busy player this early part of the ball game.
You get down in this red zone, everything tightens down. If you're thinking about throwing the football, which I don't think Yale is at this point, all of a sudden that you know, the boundaries become an extra defender as well as the back of the end zone.
We saw in that last play how quickly McLeod gets up into the hole, too, so the defenders really have to react fast.
Two tight ends, Johnson and Miller. Up the middle, Yale gets nothing.
Okay, now, Mr. Quarterback, what would you do in terms of the next call here?
I wouldn't run it between tackles.
I'm thinking play action.
This is the problem that Yale's had against Harvard the last 3 years that we've done the game. Play calling is good until they get inside the 15, and then it bogs down.
I would go play action. Remember that little counteraction they ran before?
Palhemas is a good runner, too.
And put him on the edge one way or the other. Yeah. That's right.
They got 36 inches and 2 downs. McLeod, touchdown, yeah!
He really hits the hole quickly.
Yeah, he does.
And it was outside that tackle box, too, so he,
great acceleration.
McLeod's 18th touchdown of the season, 17th on the ground.
And they double right on the tackle, and he's just too quick by him.
Yeah, because the defender's coming from the inside.
Interesting
really to
see McLeod and Dawson in a 40-yard sprint. Who would win?
Alan Campbell for the extra point. And Campbell with the extra point, now 26 out of 28 this season. Yale with the early lead. It's 7-0 Bulldogs.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
And so a 7-play, 51-yard drive that took 3 minutes.
That's later.
46 seconds. That's like last year's game.
Again, some great blocking on the part of the offensive line for Yale there, and they just kind of shut down that outside of the defense for Harvard, and McLeod just slices in.
This is a surprise in that Yale to this point of the game, 75 yards of offense, Harvard minus 10. Chang Ho and Neil Sherlock are standing deep for Harvard, awaiting the kick from Alan Campbell. And so Yale looking for its 8th win of the year as an early lead. From the 10, Sherlock out to about the 27-yard line. And we welcome you to Harvard Stadium, Cambridge, Massachusetts, the 123rd game between Harvard and Yale. Charlie Steiner, Dan Jenkins, Brian Dowling, Candace Krueger on this beautiful Saturday afternoon. Final game of the season. Final game, of course, for the seniors, especially Clifton Dawson, the single back, on first and 10 from the 28-yard line. Harvard at 7-2, 4-2 in the Ivy League this year. Liam O'Hagan in his fifth game up over center gives to Dawson. And Dawson gets to the line of scrimmage, and that's about all. Kirk Porter made the tackle, the junior from Silver Spring, Maryland.
What Harvard looked like they were trying to do there is attack the bubble, and that is where the linebacker is off the line of scrimmage between the two down linemen. But that bubble burst quickly,
very quickly,
quicker than the real estate market recently.
On second and long. So the Yale defense, which has struggled all year, has come out blazing. The pass incomplete to Corey Mazza. It is third down.
You can still see the timing for O'Hagan, the Harvard quarterback, is just not there. That's purely a timing pattern right there. And again, it's in front of the receiver by about 2 yards. So he's coming back.
It's tough missing half the season.
That's right.
Last week, losing at Penn 22-13, Tim Murphy said, frankly, that O'Hagan just had an off day. And he hasn't had much of an on day to this point. Bad snap from center. Let's see what O'Hagan can do on this play. He falls down at the 29, well short of the first down.
Slips on that new field turf. I didn't think that was supposed to happen. And he did a nice job just to pick this one up and get out to the edge. He had said that tuck this one and run. There was no opportunity for him to throw it at all.
Well, three and out, three times in a row for Harvard. And now Matt Schindel will punt. It's his best punt of the day. Henley with a fair catch at the 35. So here comes Yale with their third drive offensively when we come back to Cambridge. 7-0 Bulldogs.
We hope you're enjoying our coverage of the game for the fall of 2020. Today we're watching the game from back in 2006, and we're pleased to be joined by then defensive back coach and current head coach of the Yale Bulldogs, Tony Reno. And coach, when you look back at this 2006 Yale football team, they were a group that knew how to build on momentum.
Really did, Ev. When you look at the team, you started the season with a really, really tough loss to San Diego. And, you know, what we know now is that was a heck of a San Diego team with an NFL quarterback. We didn't know that then. And just really had to do some soul searching after that game. And, you know, went in, reeled off, eight wins in a row, I believe. Seven wins in a row. And, and was able to get into the Yale Bowl against Princeton and had a tough loss and then had a win against Harvard for all the marbles. So, but the team, you know, as the season went on, played a lot of tight games, you know, whether it was the Cornell game, we had to really, you know, make some plays of special teams defense or a Penn game in overtime, a Lehigh game in overtime. I mean, the team really knew how to, you know, play in all three phases and play off of each other really well.
A couple of weeks ago, we watched the Brown game from 2006, and you and I didn't get a chance to talk about it, so I'll ask you about it now. That was one of, if not the most entertaining football game that we've watched this fall.
Yeah, it was. It was a great game. I mean, you know, you had it all. I mean, you had good offensive plays, you know, defensive returns, interceptions for touchdowns, you know, kick returns for touchdowns. Seems like every time Yale plays at Brown, it's a wild game, and that one's for the books.
When we look back at this 2006 Harvard game, we get to see this team do something that they haven't been faced with since week two of the season, and that was rebound from a loss. And they had to do it with the Ivy League title on the line.
Really, I mean, it was a young defense. You know, a lot of sophomores and a freshman starting, a couple juniors mixed in, and you know, offense was really driven by you know, Mike McLeod at running back and Matt Bolhemus. But you know, I think the story of that game was the two lines. I mean, the offensive defensive line. The offensive line really took that game over, allowed you know, allowed us to run the ball and allowed Matt time to throw the ball effectively. Had some huge third down receptions by Chandler Henley, who had done it all season long. You know, defensively, you know, created turnovers. It was a huge turnover that was created at the start of the second half that was returned for a touchdown by Steve Santoro, which really just opened that game up. And, you know, that team was pretty resilient. You know, they walked into that game with the mentality that they were going to, you know, they weren't going to be denied.
We haven't had a chance to talk about him much at all this fall, but Chandler Henley here in 2006 is a fifth-year senior, and he's the captain. An incredible player and an incredible leader, and has continued his career in football.
Yeah, Chandler was a really inclusive leader. You know, I've been fortunate to be around some great captains, and, you know, Chandler's right up there with the best. And he was a very inclusive leader in the sense where, you know, he was able to really, as a fifth year, you know, grab the seniors and the freshmen and the sophomores and the juniors and bring them all together. He did a really nice job of enabling and empowering others to lead as well. And you know, I think from a leadership point of view, he was amazing. And obviously it's gone on in his career. I mean, he was a coach on our 2017 Ivy League championship team. And now he's a offensive quality control coach with the Tennessee Titans. So he's done an incredible job since he's left Yale.
Coach, anything in particular that we should look out for in what ends up being a great day for the Bulldogs?
Well, I think that, you know, when you watch the game, you know, obviously Mike McLeod was a special player. I mean, he was at his, you know, at his best in 2006 and 2007 before he got injured in 2008. And I mean, he's just a dominant player. I mean, the school up north had a heck of a running back too named Clifton Dawson, who, you know, going into the game was really the, you know, he was really the gold standard of running backs in the Ivy League. And it was kind of the passing of the torch from, you know, from Dawson to McLeod in that game between the two of them.
That was Tony Reno, head coach of the Yale Bulldogs. Don't go anywhere. Yale and Harvard from 2006 continues now.
And it's going to be very close. It looks like there may be a fumble.
He put it on the ground. But what he's saying is he bounced on the ground on top of the ball.
Harvard maintains possession. And there will be a measurement.
Looks like he's a couple inches short. Mistakes on the sideline record.
They never are. That's a great thing.
And so they'll bring in the chains. Harvard still in search of its first down of the ball game.
It looks like there might be.
Okay, here's a good question. The chains are now offset from the sideline about 3 feet. Mm-hmm. How do they mark it to the sideline then?
It's all a guesstimate. See, that's the way things work now. Yeah, see, they're about 6 inches shy. Maybe you must have not.
When you're that close, do you dare risk it?
He's going to go for it.
Yep.
Oh, and you got Clifton Dawson, the all-time leading rusher for the Ivy League in the backfield. Or does O'Hagan sneak it? Or do they hope that Yale will jump offside?
Oh, I see. Marks it on the yard line, on the chain.
Well, there's a sneak. We'll have to wait and see what the forward progress is.
They've gotten it by about 2 inches.
Yeah, they got it.
He may have gotten it by the length of his face mask.
George Karras was our offensive line coach here when I was playing. He used to tell us in situations like that, if you can't get that kind of yardage, you don't deserve to be out there.
Geez, you ain't.
Oh, this was a bad spot, though. Now I'm going to talk about the 1 foot, inch, 2 foot.
I think they made it by an inch.
They only needed two.
From our perspective up here, it looks like it. This guy's more running than
they're used to. The guys with the chains.
That's it.
He just came back from KFC. You want fries with that?
Oh, this is short.
No, it's not.
Huh? Okay. He got it by 4 inches.
He needed two, and he picked up 6 inches. Made it by 4. So it's first down. That's Harvard's first down of the ball game.
Sometimes that's what it takes just mentally to get you back into the game as an offense, just to have something positive happen for them. They're spreading them out now. We're crossing through the trips to the right.
O'Hagan looking for his first pass reception of the day, and he's got it.
He's one of the A-Bear twins.
Neil Sherlock is lucky to get to the line of scrimmage. In fact, he loses one on the play.
See, what they're doing is they're trying to spread the defense out, and if you get past that first level, then you got some room to run with the trips out there. But the problem is you got to hit that. If you turn up the field, you've got to go. You can't wait to find out where a defender is, because he's looking for you normally.
Sherlock now slot to the left. O'Hagan from the shotgun with Dawson alongside. Here's Clifton. And he gets to the line of scrimmage. Yale has done a great job in containing this Division I AA All-American. Chris Barry made the tackle. Jackside Leckie, now in his 10th year at Yale, replaced Carm Koza, who retired after the 1996 season. Third and 10. O'Hagan gets crushed as he releases the pass. Incomplete, flag on the play. Corey Mazza, the intended receiver, and it looks like Casey Gerald is the man in trouble.
Boy, that's a tough call on him, because that ball was up high enough that I thought that maybe Corey was calling for a fair catch on it.
He got hit just as he let go of the ball, but it looked more like face guarding than than physical
interference.
Pass interference on the defense, number one. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
And again, you see Corey Mazza's making his move. Now he wants to stop, plant, and come back. And right there is where, if your defender turns around, looks for that ball, he's got the right to it as well. But O'Hagan really got nailed just as he delivered the pass right here. And those are the kind of back and rib shots that will make you a little sore come Monday morning.
Brant Hollander delivered that blow, and the penalty to Gerald could have been holding, face masking, interference, take your pick. Either way, it's a first down for Harvard. O'Hagan, long pass, sideline, incomplete. Intended for Matt Luff, Paul Rice in on the play defensively.
One of the things we should point out about the Harvard offensive line, because sometimes you've seen some pressure get in there for the quarterback. They're missing both of their starting tackles, and that was just a great defensive play there.
Steve Santoro almost came up with the interception on that loose ball. 14.
He stayed right with the receiver all the way down the field.
Second and 10. O'Hagan breaks a tackle. Here's Dawson to the 31-yard line and the second first down of the game for the Crimson. Brandon Sponheimer made the tackle, 99.
And that time you saw O'Hagan get away from some pressure, pass rush pressure, and was able to come out there and make a move.
So Harvard now beginning to get its sea legs about them as they've got a first down. This is their deepest penetration into Yale territory. Time running out in the first quarter. Chang Ho is brought down at about the 27-yard line. Chang Ho.
An interesting story there, huh?
Indeed. From Taiwan. Did not come over to the United States until 5 years ago. He's a freshman. He didn't know what a football was when he got here.
And now he's the backup to Clifton Davis and Clifton Dawson, and a guy who Coach Murphy says is one of those guys, a complete effort guy. Every time he carries the football, he got the great effort coming out of it.
The heir apparent to Clifton Dawson, who's the deep back in the I formation. And there's Clifton in his final game. Brought down at the line of scrimmage and gets nothing. Kirk Porter brings him to the turf. And that brings us to the end of the first quarter of the 123rd playing of the Harvard-Yale game, simply called The Game. So we're going to take a break, and when we come back, it'll be to the second quarter. And it's been a good first quarter for Yale. They lead it 7-0. In the final game of Clifton Dawson's collegiate career, there's his mom seeing her son play for the first time. She has never been to a Harvard football game. Clifton grew up in Scarborough, Ontario, the youngest of 9 children. And so mom has come down to watch the Ivy League's all-time leading rusher play in his final game. He's already been drafted by the Toronto Argonauts in the CFL. It is third down and about 5 yards to go on the first play of the second quarter. And Dawson with a stutter step has himself a first down and more, and wrestled down to the 12-yard line.
That was the move. He completely just gave up on the run, and that was just kind of a fake. And watch him here as he does his little stall move right there and then comes back outside and gets extra yardage on the play.
Yeah, and about a 10-yard gain, he made 6 cuts.
That's right. Unbelievable stuff there. And Jared with the
Hamilton
old stiff arm.
Made the tackle. And on first and 10 at about the 14, here's Dawson again. And this time he is really brought down by Brand Hollander, the junior from Indianapolis. Well, in the first quarter, statistically speaking, Yale won just about every battle except time of possession. But all importantly, they lead 7-0.
When you're winning time of possession, you have a minus 2 yards rushing. That means
something's
you've just been getting exercise.
That's right.
On second down, O'Hagan. Screen pass. Matt Farbutko, the tight end, to the 5-yard line. Short of a first down by a couple.
One of the fun things about a screen is you always wonder when the defensive linemen get to the quarterback that quickly. And it hasn't been that way all day. Why do they not recognize that it's a screen pass?
Well, they're so anxious to get that sack, and you break free that quickly. It's tough to you put on the brakes.
All you can see is that quarterback sitting back there like a little lamb.
Luft and Mazza flanked to the left. Dawson the single back, third and a couple. Here's Dawson bouncing his way very close to a first down. Chris Barry, the linebacker from Dallas, Texas, made the tackle. Candace, what's going on downstairs?
Well, guys, Coach Murphy speaks very highly of his stellar running back. He told me Clifton Dawson is the most consistent football player he's ever been around, and he couldn't say enough about him off the field either. He told me he's a model of humility and class.
Transferred in from Northwestern, and one of the great stories is that Coach Murphy tells about how he got here and why he got here. He said he wanted to come here for a great education, and obviously he was a fine football player, and we were just fortunate, I think, and blessed to get him here.
So Clifton Dawson and his mentor, Tim Murphy. Harvard calls time. 12:44 to go in the half, 7-0 Yale. Fourth and less than one. Harvard with the ball. They have to get inside the Yale four. And everybody is bunched up tight. Dawson has it. So the incomparable senior from Scarborough, Ontario. Clifton Dawson with the first down and quarterback.
Dan, you mentioned him coming over from Northwestern. Obviously, he didn't want to become the next Denzel Washington.
Well, he's a young man with a background. I mean, a very difficult background growing up. And obviously, he's made the most of it here. And I have a feeling that whatever he decides to do with the remainder of his life is going to be a real success.
O'Hagan. Just short. To finish up on the story, we were talking yesterday with Tim Murphy, the head coach at Harvard, about Dawson transferring to Harvard from Northwestern. And they had the first meeting. They did, the great running back and the head coach, and then the first question that Murphy wanted to know was, hey, so why are you here? He said, I really wanted to come for an education. And Murphy's thinking to himself, yeah, right. And on second and goal, touchdown.
And there's
he's graduate. Also got some good vertical leap, too.
That's your graduate work.
That's right.
Well, that was Dr. Clifton.
Yes.
Dr. Clifton Dawson.
And so I
asked Murphy, I said, well, when did you come to believe that he was really telling you the truth? And he said, about halfway through his freshman year.
And here he is with a nice dive. And that kind of reminds me of a guy I used to play with, number 34, Walter Payton. Walter liked to do that dive from about 3 yards out.
His 22nd touchdown of the season for Clifton Dawson. And with the extra point by Schindel, the game is tied at 7. A 17-play, 68-yard drive that took almost 7 minutes. And Harvard has pulled all even, 7-7, in the 123rd playing of the game.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
The reason why I think it means so much to me is because for all the players that, you know, who've played alongside me, all the offensive linemen who have such a huge part of this, current and past, you know, over the last 4 years, and you know, I'd hope that it means as much to them as it does to me, and you know, I feel happy for all those guys who can share in it.
Clifton Dawson's 22nd touchdown of the season, capping off a 17-play, 68-yard drive. And he is arguably the greatest running back in the history of the Ivy League.
Breaking Ed Marinaro's all-time rushing record here in the Ivy League. Ed, of course, was at Cornell, and his last place that he played was with us in the Chicago Bear organization. And he didn't make it out of training camp, and that's when he knew he was going to go into the acting business full-time, and boy, what a career he's had doing that.
He did it in 29 games, and Dawson did it in 39 games, but almost identical number of attempts.
It's amazing.
Of course, when Marinaro played, there was something called freshman football.
And
this is Steve Santoro, and Santoro is brought down at the 36-yard line, so Yale now tied at 7 will have good field position for its first series of the second quarter.
Dawson's a good-looking guy. Line. Maybe he'd get involved with Hasty Pudding after the season's over. And then go to Hollywood.
Whatever he's going to do in it with the rest of his life, it's going to be a success story.
From the 36, the quarterback, Matt Palemis, is joined in the backfield by Mike McLeod. Palemis is going to run on his own. Turns the corner and is knocked out around the 43. A little more than 11 minutes to go in the first half.
You know, this sideline judge, he didn't mark the spot he went out. He went looking to see if he was okay to pick him up, and he misspotted the ball about another 2 yards.
He's an area guy. You know, yeah, it's in the right area.
As
long as it's not close to the goal line, I guess it's okay.
That's it.
Second down, about 1 yard to go, and we are tied at seven. It's been a very good first half. Bolemus, the junior quarterback from Chatham, Massachusetts, gives to McLeod from New Britain, Connecticut, and he's brought down at the 41. And Yale continues to move the ball.
And Charlie, one of the things that's happening is the Harvard defensive line is slanting. And what you try to accomplish with those slants is to slant into the play call side. That time, they slanted to the right, and the play was going back the opposite way, and they got caught on that one. So you try to get some kind of a read on what the defense is doing offensively. You try to get a read on when they slant and where they slant. And that time, Yale just guessed it right and turned into a nice play for them.
First and 10 at the 41. A little delay, and McLeod is brought down in the backfield. A terrific tackle made by Glenn Doris. If Doris doesn't get McLeod, McLeod might have gone all the way.
You know, even though Dawson has had an almost non-existent first quarter, both these guys can have the quickness to get through the line and break a long one at any time, mm-hmm. And that's what I think both defenses are very wary of.
Again, there's another look at it, and you can see one of the things that is fascinating to watch, too, about this offense for Yale is the quarterback carrying out the play fakes. We'll talk about that
later. Bolemus throws on the run, and he completes it to DJ Shooter. And that's a first down at the 27.
That was a major league throw. Just a rollout, and he's got a short down and out and a longer one down and out, and he fires it right in there. Boy, that's a nice pass.
Mm-hmm. Takes a little bit of a beating from Michael Berg, and coming in from the outside.
That would have been a penalty in the NFL.
Yeah, exactly right.
That was Desmond Bryant, number 90.
6'5", 260 pounds.
So it's first and 10. Yale moving the ball well here in this drive. McLeod up the middle. McLeod to the 10, still on his feet, and brought down inside the 5.
That was some outstanding running there. You know, you always talk about running backs keeping their legs moving to keep driving the football. Well, that's exactly what McLeod accomplished. He got some nice blocking from his offensive line.
The quickness of these two running backs, he goes right up the middle, which is usually not the place that he's going to break one, but it shows the strength there, staying on his feet.
And about three missed tackles later, then he finally gets brought down.
First and goal inside the 5-yard line. McLeod again. He's got room. He's got a touchdown. McLeod, who had 4 touchdowns last week against Princeton, comes up with his 18th touchdown of the season.
I like the fact that he went old school when he scored. He gave the ball to the official.
And the official didn't catch it. He had his hands in the air. Watch this. And right there, boy, it's casual. He flips to the official, and it's good. It goes right through his uprights.
Everybody slammed inside, and he just took it to the edge.
And the extra point by Alan Campbell is good. And Yale with the 14-7 lead.
And once again, you know, offensive lines do a great job when you have a running back like this of getting people off the line of scrimmage there. You saw even the tight end got involved in it, pushing that defense off the line of scrimmage.
And both of these guys have quickness, have such quickness that they might change the hole where the play's designed to go. As mm-hmm. long as the blockers stay on their man, they have the quickness to sort of pick their own holes.
That's it. Get them off the line of scrimmage, get them moving, and let the running back use his talents.
Let's go downstairs, Candace Kruger.
Well, Mike McLeod, of course, has had some great success this season, but he told me as far as today's game goes, he doesn't have any personal goals. He just wants to do his part in helping his team win. Charlie.
Well, mission accomplished. McLeod, a sophomore from New Britain, Connecticut. There's Matt Bolemus, the quarterback.
Just coming down, playing a run.
Rushed for 204 yards against Lehigh last month and scored the game-winning touchdown. Neil Sherlock gets nothing, and doesn't even come close to the 20. He asked what has been happening up front. Well, Yale's defense in the interior of their defensive line have been playing outstanding football in this ball game. And then you try to string it out and the linebackers get involved. And they've really been shutting down Harvard's rushing game until that last Harvard drive that led to a touchdown. Now Harvard having to come from behind again, trailing 14-7. O'Hagan to throw. Being flushed out of the pocket. Running for his life and is lucky to get back to the line of scrimmage. Actually falls a yard or two short.
It's amazing how the offenses have changed almost 75% to shotgun formation.
Yeah, you know, and part of the reason why sometimes centers, you know, resist it a little bit because it's a different snap for the center. The other thing is the quarterbacks now, what happens when that ball is coming into their hands out of the shotgun, as you well know, is you have to take your eye off the field.
You can't make the read on the first couple steps.
Right.
Second and 11. Here's Dawson. Gets to the 20 and maybe a yard or two. Boy, the Yale defense has done just a terrific job in containing this great running back.
What they've done is they've denied them the opportunity to run the football inside, so now you know you've kind of limited them to the tackle area. And again, as we were mentioning a little earlier, Harvard had lost both of its starting offensive tackles, one Nick Sovich last week to a broken leg. So, you know, you're looking at a real adjustment along the offensive line.
Third and a long nine. O'Hagan throws incomplete. Intended for Mazza. And again, the Yale defense, which ranked dead last in the Ivy League coming into the final game of the regular season, has been terrific.
And this is the Liam O'Hagan we were expecting to see all day. This is one who he squeezes into an area. That's a wonderful pass.
That's a great
right there.
Throw and unbelievable defense by Casey.
He was all over him, wasn't he?
Casey Gerald, number one. Knocked the ball away at the last instant. And now Matt Schindel to punt it away. And Chandler Henley with the fair catch at the 41-yard line. We're going to take a break about halfway through the second quarter. And Yale leads by 7. Yale with the 14-7 lead. And about halfway through the second quarter, Yale has outrushed Harvard 88-18. And the story of the game has been Mike McLeod, frankly, outrunning to this point the great Clifton Dawson. And so let's see what McLeod can do this time around. He has scored both of the Yale touchdowns. Palimas throwing over the middle, well overthrown. Intended for Chandler Henley.
One of the things we heard Jack Zidlecki talking about this offense the last time they came off was the fact that the Harvard defense was pursuing so much they wanted to go throw the football a little bit now because the idea is to get them in that chase kind of a situation and then you can take away some of it with your play action. And that's why we're talking about quarterback fakes and it's so important for you to follow out that quarterback fake every time.
Palimas on the year has completed 53% of his passes. And McLeod gets nothing this time. As Doug Hewlett, the weak side safety, came up to make the tackle. Hewlett from Wellington, Florida, 6'3", 200 pounds, a junior. So third down, about 8 yards to go. Just an ideal football afternoon in Cambridge, Massachusetts. Temperature now about 50 degrees and just some puffy white clouds overhead. A beautiful day. Palimas on second efforts got the first down. Michael Berg, the senior nose tackle from Stanford, Connecticut, made the tackle.
And think about that. That's a nose tackle out there on the perimeter making the stop. That's what we talked about. Michael Berg at the top of the game runs that 4.6 40, and he really had to get rolling this time to make the play.
And Palema shows he's some leg strength here because he could have been tackled right there, and he gets
Ryan
eight
Tully
more yards.
It. That's it.
10 more yards.
Leg strength, great balance. First down at the 45 of the Crimson. Here's Palemas rolling, throwing, and completing to Chandler Henley. Short of a first down by about a yard. Let's go downstairs, Candace Kruger.
Well, guys, Chandler Henley broke his collarbone 4 days into preseason practice last year and had to sit out all of last season. He told me that year off gave him a better perspective of the game. He said he now appreciates it more and enjoys playing more. He feels that's why he's been so successful this season.
The senior from Littleton, Colorado. Second, a short one. Well, that's a free play. And unless he was drawn across, it's a first down for Yale.
Well, one of the things is standard operating procedure if you're a defensive lineman and you jump off, you do point to the offensive line.
Yeah,
just
true.
In case you can get one.
Offsides on the defense, number 96. 5-yard penalty results in a first down.
And that time, Michael Berg is just a little bit too quick.
Sounds like he's getting a little tan on the top of his head today with the sunshine.
Yeah.
So Yale with another first down at the Harvard 31. Remember, they led at halftime last year. And around, there is nobody there.
That was a dangerous pass.
Well,
that's
either,
one that
either
should
he throws it or it's a 10-yard loss.
I would have taken the loss because I tell you what, that one was close to coming back the other way. And there's nothing but green in between.
Reed Lathan, 27, a defensive back, threw the ball, well, like a defensive back.
Watch this. If this ball is intercepted, the whole side of the field is wide open.
His first, his only opportunity to throw the ball, that, you know, the eyes get big as saucers.
And, balloons one up there.
Second and 10. Now McLeod gets nothing.
One of the things that's hurt the Harvard defense today has been the tackling. It hasn't been some sure tackling today, and finally there you see some.
Brad Bagdis, the junior from Paxton, Massachusetts, 6'3", 235, made the play. So third down and very long. Matt Murray is now in the backfield. McLeod gets this play off on third and about 12. Let's see what Palemas can do. Henley is generally his third down guy. And the pass is caught inside the 15, down to the 11, and it was Chandler Henley with the first down.
Harvard came with an all-out blitz. It's amazing how often the offense has the advantage when the ball is underthrown.
Because
mm-hmm. he was well covered
by Andrew Berry, and then watch his cover.
See right here, well covered, but underthrows it.
Well, on a blitz, though, you got to also know as a defender, that ball's going to be in the air almost automatically. Either that or the quarterback's going to get slammed, and he got slammed anyway.
That was the 15th pass thrown to Henley this year on third down, the 14th for a first down. And McLeod gets to the 10, a gain of a yard or two. So Chandler Henley comes up with yet another clutch reception. And Jackside Lucky has to just love the way his Bulldogs have responded so far this afternoon here in Cambridge at
Henley
Harvard Field.
Excuse me, Harley, Charlie. Henley really looks comfortable as a receiver.
Mm-hmm.
Just very confident running routes and adjusting to the ball.
His final game for the Bulldogs. Second down, about 8. McLeod gets nothing.
A
great play by Glenn Doris. We're calling his name, the sophomore from Marietta, Georgia, quite a bit so far in the first half.
And Brad Bagdis is the guy, 81, on this play that makes a great stop. We talk about boxing the corner. Watch him shut this corner down right there, stops the offensive lineman, jams the play up, and allows the play to be made from the inside. And that's Glenn Doris who came in and made the stop, the inside linebacker. But it's all because of what happened on that edge, on that corner. He shut it down.
So Doris gets the stat, but Bagdis makes the play. On third down, about 11. For the end zone, incomplete, and no flag. Actually, right the intended receiver.
And Andrew Bird did a nice job that time, forcing the play to the boundary. And the receiver had nowhere to run but out of bounds.
There's a little contact there, but I think the ball was uncatchable, so there's no flag.
Alan Kimball is now on for the field goal try.
Here's the play again. Watch Barry there. See, he turns this time and looks for the ball a little bit, and that allows him to drift.
Kimball from 30.
The referee's looking in the sun.
Tax
flipping
on
the shades.
Three. And Yale with a 17-7 lead. 2:49 to go, first half. Bulldogs sitting pretty.
You can make it if you try.
And on this dog day afternoon, Yale has a 17-7 lead.
And I take it that that Bulldog has been around a little bit longer than UGA 5 or UGA 6 down at the University of Georgia.
Sold out house of 30,000 plus. The century-old Harvard Stadium. Neil Sherlock to the 31-yard line, and that's where Harvard takes over. Trailing with 2:38 to go in the half. But of course, both Harvard and Yale have a vested interest in what's going on down in Princeton today. And Dartmouth at 2-7, visiting Princeton 8-1. Should Dartmouth win today, either A, Yale can win the Ivy League outright, or B, if Harvard wins, there could be a three-way tie for the championship. So a lot riding down in Princeton. We'll keep you up to date on that game. Matt Farbatko, the big tight end, is brought down at the 49-yard line, the senior from Brookline, New Hampshire. And a first down. So you see, there's Princeton sitting atop the charts. They lose. And but as you see, Dartmouth is 2-7.
Stranger things have happened in this league, that's for sure.
So on first and 10. 2:10, first half. O'Hagan's throw down the sideline, incomplete. Corey Mazza, the intended receiver.
And we go back to talking about O'Hagan getting an opportunity to get back in the game and start games, and the timing aspect of having missed so much with the starting group, pretty difficult.
O'Hagan missed the first five games of the year. Suspended. Chris Pizzotti quarterbacked in his stead. And there is movement on both sides of the line. Who moved first?
I'm going to say it was Zach Koppel. They usually get the offensive line.
False start on the offense, number 77.
Yeah, there you go.
5-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
You can't even eye twitch sometimes. No. They'll get you.
Yeah, you know, when you get that hard count by the quarterback, you want to just go hit somebody.
Well, when you're 6'4 and 290, it's hard to disguise movement.
That's exactly right.
That twitch has become a little more pronounced.
Kind of tsunami. Second down, 15. O'Hagan's long throw has a lot of air underneath it, and it is picked off by Steve Santoro. Santoro to the 35-40. He's got the sideline and is finally knocked out of bounds at the 41-yard line. So Yale with a big turnover with a minute and 49 seconds to go in the half.
And that ball was floated into triple coverage. That's one thing you can't do when you're throwing to the middle of the field. That's where everybody gets an opportunity to collapse on the pass, and that's exactly what happened.
Well, Maz is in position to catch it, but Santoro comes over and cuts in front of him.
Yeah, unfortunately, the three defenders in position to catch it as well, and one of them dead. And Liam O'Hagan got slammed after he released this one.
Steve Santoro's fourth interception of the season.
Playing safety, I always like those high ones down the middle. More like catching a punt than intercepting it.
It came out of the air like a parachute.
Kyle Hawari is the guy who got in there, number 90, for Yale and got that pressure on O'Hagan.
First down.
Actually, one of the first lessons you're taught as a quarterback is the most dangerous place is high down the middle.
Down the middle of the field, that's exactly it.
And it took forever to come out of the sky. And so now on first down, Yale with a glorious opportunity. Kolima stops, throws, and he completes it to the tight end, Johnston, all the way down to the 6-yard line. Langston Johnson from Los Altos, California, with his second big reception of the day. And what's interesting about Johnson is he had two receptions all year coming into the game.
And this was like a little misdirection again with the action to the left and then coming back to the right. And there's Jack Ford down on the sideline.
He looks bigger than 6'2", and it's amazing that he only has two catches coming into today.
Mm-hmm. Well, he has doubled his pleasure this afternoon, and now it's first and goal at the 6. And McLeod going for his third touchdown of the day, but it's not going to happen on this play as he's brought down by Desmond Bryant, number 90.
And number 62, Matt Curtis is also in on the play early on. To try to wrap him up a little bit. I mentioned Jack Ford is down on the sideline. Now, he was a quarterback at Yale. Was he before or after you?
He was after.
After?
He wasn't a quarterback. He was a defensive end.
Oh, was he?
Yeah.
No, seriously.
Yeah, he was. He was about the time that he was class of 72. Oop.
Polinas picks up the drop ball, and Wisely just throws it away. It's third down.
Isn't it funny and odd how sometimes a football that's oblong will bounce straight back up like a basketball, and that was the situation there. Third down.
So time running out on the first half, and Yale looking for some insurance. And time is going to be called by the Bulldogs. Well, of course, at halftime last year, Yale was sitting pretty. They didn't finish pretty. Let's take a look back on what happened in last year's memorable game. This time last year, the 122nd edition of the game, among the most memorable in history. Yale got off to an early start. 3 first half touchdowns. A great catch by DJ Shooter. A 5-yard run by Mike McLeod. But Harvard, down 21-3, came back in the fourth quarter. First, an interception by Steve Williams. And then Alex Bro's touchdown catch would tie the game at 24. And so on into overtime they played, the first time in the history of the game. Yale turned the ball over 3 times, including an interception by Harvard's interior lineman, Michael Berg, the first of his career. And that would set the stage in third overtime for Clifton Dawson to score the game-winning touchdown. Harvard 30, Yale 24, ending the longest game in the history of the Ivy League. And in talking to the Yale folks over the last couple of days, they were saying it took weeks to get over that loss because of the attention and the acclaim, the length of the game received, the fact that it is Harvard and Yale. And for Tim Murphy, that was his 5th consecutive win over the Bulldogs a year ago. Princeton now a 7-0 lead in the first half in New Jersey over Dartmouth. Polimas' throw is incomplete. Henley, the intended receiver, it's 3rd and goal.
That pass intended for Chandler Henley. Stephen Williams.
Once again, there's the Princeton score. Princeton, they win today. Regardless, they're going to win a championship. But if they should happen to lose to Dartmouth and Harvard win today, then Harvard, Yale, and Princeton would share in the championship. Yale wins it, then they, along with Princeton, go home very happy.
Here's Alan Kimball, 1-for-1 on a field goal attempt this afternoon, looking to make it 2-for-2 and a 20-7 lead, and that's exactly what has just happened. So with 45 seconds to go in the half, Yale has the lead, but that's been SOP for the Bulldogs over the last year or more. They get off to the great first half start and seem to peter out in the second half.
And a lot of times people ask you, say, well, what are the halftime adjustments? What do you do at halftime, and how well do you make those adjustments? And I think that may be another part of the story in terms of what Harvard decides to do coming out for the second half, how to take advantage of what they are doing offensively, especially for Yale.
Also, game plans usually get compressed a little bit at halftime. So you focus on what's working and get away from what's not. Plus, both coaches will say, you've got to eliminate the turnovers.
Well, the turnovers have really haunted Harvard here in the first half as Yale's able to tack on three more points on the intercept by Liam O'Hagan. Clifton Dawson now is awaiting the kickoff along with Neil Sherlock in the final 45 seconds of the half. Dawson, having trouble with the sun, watches the ball go into the end zone. It'll be a touchback. A lonely moment for Clifton Dawson. We'll be visiting with him at half.
That kick into the end zone for a touchback.
And much more on this glorious Saturday afternoon.
You know what's interesting? To look up to the top rim of the stadium, and they put some things in here that are kind of fascinating. And for those around the country that don't know, Harvard and Yale both have won some national championships in college football. And I believe there are 7 up here and 20-some down at Yale. And you also see the Ivy titles up around the rim of the stadium as well.
We won't tell the folks at home that they were about the only two teams playing in the first 30 years of football.
Never ruin a good story, my
<That's>
friend.
<right. laughs>
Dawson is really smacked down at the 21. Truth in advertising. The last time, well, you take a look at the Ivy League champions.
Uh-huh.
Now you swing the camera to the left. The other one.
There we go.
Keep going.
There we go.
All right, now the good old days.
I don't know how good they were, but the football teams were good.
We had no highlights, and we have no time left in the first half. But it's been a very good half for the Bulldogs as Clifton Dawson and his Harvard Crimson go into the clubhouse trailing 20-7.
And a great thing to see the crowd today coming back to this game. We've got a crowd of over 36,000 folks here. And that kind of reminds you of the way things used to be at the Harvard-Yale games, and particularly all throughout the season. And this is a good thing for Ivy League football, I think, to start to see the competitive nature come back to it, as well as the crowds and the people who are interested in the game.
It is just a beautiful afternoon. 50 degrees, nary a cloud in the sky, and it was a well-played first half, especially for the Yale Bulldogs, who, if they can win this game this afternoon, will have at least a portion of the Ivy League championship for the first time since 1999. They came into the game 7-2, 5-1 in the Ivy League, and like last year, they have a lead on Harvard at the half. Let's go downstairs now, Candace Krueger.
Coach Sedlecki, you've talked to me about how young and inexperienced your defense is. It certainly doesn't look like that today. You guys have done a phenomenal job. Held Clifton Dawson to under 30 yards.
And we got to just keep playing. We got 30 more minutes. We got to play with that kind of enthusiasm and that kind of attitude. We can't take a step back for a second. You know, it's ours to get. We got to play it for 30. That's what it is. We got to have 30 more minutes just like those 30. We can't step off, can't let up. We're going to play with an attitude, and we're going to come out to win this football game in the second half.
Thanks, Coach. Good luck.
Thank you.
Jack Sedlecki, in his 10th year at Yale, looking for his 4th win against Harvard. And at the half, he's halfway there.
Behind.
Clifton Dawson, last year's hero, so far this afternoon. Clifton Dawson has essentially been held in check as Yale leads it 20-7. And gents, surprisingly, the Yale defense has come up and played awfully well.
I really think that's the big part of the story is their rush defense has been sensational against Clifton Dawson. And we talk about 23 yards for a guy that leads the league in rushing. In terms of the history of the league, just unbelievable. A great play by the Yale defense, and then offensively, they've been getting after it. They've been really stretching out the Harvard D. The run game with McLeod, he has been sensational. He's the leading rusher this year in the Ivy League. And we talked about Clifton Dawson. Look at this run here. This is probably his best run of the day. Got him down near the end zone, and then a little bit later on, you're going to get an opportunity to see him punch it through. Goes over the top and dives into the end zone for the lone touchdown for Harvard today. And you talk about McLeod, well, here he comes back at you. And you see the little shake and bake there. Gets down near the end zone. And look at how many missed tackles there are on him. And that's because of his movement. Watch his feet. They never stop moving. And that time he just cruised into the end zone.
McLeod with 19 of Yale's 30 touchdowns this season. He's got both of them today. In terms of time of possession, really not that big a difference. But some mistakes by Harvard, the turnovers have hurt him, and Yale, with a win today, can get themselves at least a portion of the Ivy League championship. We're getting ready for the second half of play. Remember last year, Yale had the big halftime lead. That was last year.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
Well, as we mentioned last year, Yale had the big halftime lead, as they do again this year. Can they hang on? And if they do, they will have at least a portion of the Ivy League championship for the first time since 1999. Mike McLeod had a big day, and Tim Murphy has some work to do. However, the third quarter for the Crimson has been their best quarter of the year.
One of the things that will help defensively is if, they wrap up on tackles. They have probably given up another 40 yards of offense to Yale because of missed tackles.
Well, you got to give the other team a little credit.
Yeah, you do. They're
both white.
You have them wrapped up, though. You got to bring them down.
Right. Every time you touch somebody, it doesn't necessarily mean they're going to go down.
So Yale's got the big lead, and they'll have possession to begin the second half. As Matt Schindel kicks it off. And kicks it out of bounds. So Yale gets another break. Harvard has just played sloppy football.
They really have. You know, and I hate to say this. Because
free kick out of bounds.
Because it sounds really bad, but it's almost
we'll
like.
We'll spot the ball on the 35-yard line.
Locked into this first game down. Mentally from the beginning. And, that's not to say anything bad about Yale. They've come out and done what they're supposed to do, and that is put points on the board. But when you look at Harvard's effort so far today, and that's why I go back to the missed tackles, because that's all a part of the mental side of the game, getting after people.
Penalties, missed tackles, turnovers. And with that, Yale has a 13-point lead. Jack Sidelecki, the head coach. Matt Palemas, the quarterback, saying, thank you, all charity, happily accepted.
Mm-hmm.
First play, second half, Mike McLeod breaks a tackle, and on second effort, he gets all the way to the 39-yard line. Steve Williams, The right corner comes up to make the tackle, a pickup of about 4, 2nd and 6.
If you're a young running back, this is something you want to watch. And I don't care what level you're talking about of football. When you see a guy like McLeod running the football, that first initial pop is not going to bring him down, because what he's doing is he's continuing to move his legs. The only way to get a guy like him down to the ground is to take his legs out from underneath him. If you're hitting him up top, it's not going to bring him down.
5'11", a 200-pound sophomore is McLeod. The throw on the run. Is it intercepted? Yes, it is. Doug Hewlett.
That pass intended for number 8, well, DJ Shooter.
Yale had Harvard playing on their heels, and Palemis with the intercept. And Harvard now the recipient of the turnover.
Hewlett just cuts in front of this one.
That's a bad throw. He underthrows him, and really poor decision. It was leading the Harvard guy perfectly.
Yeah. Hewlett's first interception of the season.
He played it well. He actually had another one, an opportunity early in the game when we talked about him.
Chang Ho arrives on the field just in the nick of time. And here's the first play of the second half for Harvard. And here's Dawson. Dawson, flag on the play. Probably a hold.
The reason why you said that is because you saw a large number come up, right? You saw number 68 come up?
Well, when the referee is the one throwing the flag from behind the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, it's usually not a good sign. David Payne, I think, was the one that got nabbed on this one.
We have one foul on the play. Holding on the offense, number 68. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Repeat first down.
And 68, David Payne. There it is.
This is just not right. He just gets an outstanding block here. Now, yeah, maybe had a little bit of a hold of the guy. You know,
he only had 3 fingers under his shoulder pads.
He was going down.
You want to run that one by me one more time?
That's an offensive lineman's mentality. That's right. I never held.
You save that one for the meeting room. Winston Hill, a great coach. The Jets told me. He said, I've never held an honest man in my life.
First and 20. Here's O'Hagan's first pass of the second half. And it's complete to Martin, or make that Matt Luff.
And Matt Luff, a tall wide receiver, too, at about 6'5 and 200 pounds. So both teams have some big wide receivers, some big targets out there.
6'5, a 200-pound freshman. Thousand Oaks, California. Second about 15. Here's O'Hagan again. He's going to run it. Well, look at him. About 2 yards shy of the first down. So from first and 20, it's about 3rd and 2 now as Kirk Porter makes the tackle.
Looks like Liam may have gotten the coffee wake-up call in the locker room at halftime. And again, here's a guy that can also beat you with his legs. You know, you talk about quarterbacks that can move. He's a guy that can do that and do it in a hurry. You know, as we look back at these wide receivers, it reminds me back to the time when Eric Johnson was playing here for Yale and caught all of those passes in that game. He's been doing a sensational job for the Niners ever since then.
Dawson for the first down. He's got it to the 28.
What did he catch, 20 passes in that game, was it?
I think he had 21.
21.
Including the last one, which was incredible.
And here's Dawson now. Decides to head up the field, sees some yardage in there, and said, you know, I'm going to take advantage of it.
He only had 23 yards in the first half, but, you know, he can, as we said earlier, he could break one at any point.
All it takes is one opportunity, and he is gone.
First and 10. Dawson again. He is brought down by Chris Barry, the linebacker.
The one thing you ask as an offensive lineman, you say, look, let me get going. Let's just keep pounding that football, because every play is not going to work, but you got to give me that opportunity. If you just keep handing it off to that running back, we're going to get him back on the heels sooner or later.
So Chang Ho and Clifton Dawson alongside quarterback Liam O'Hagan in the shotgun on 2nd and 9. O'Hagan throws, incomplete, intended for Luft. He had a chance at it, and off the fingertips.
Sort of a quick post pattern, and it's catchable.
Is the sun a factor here, do you think, or is it just the no. he should have had that.
Third and nine. Has a flank to the bottom of the screen. O'Hagan's in trouble. A lot of trouble. Is that a fumble or not?
Yes. Yeah, it is.
His arm looked like it was coming forward. I don't know.
Bad decision.
Yeah.
Should take the sack.
It looked like he was trying to unload it.
Chris Number Barry 59. Recovers, and Yale has the football.
The key thing is, that was his arm coming forward? And he's trying to make his move here. Now, he should have thrown it right there if you're going to throw it. Well, his arm tried to come forward.
Well,
the
ball,
problem was the ball was behind him. That's right.
Good follow through.
And so each team with a turnover in each of their first possessions of the second half. This is about where Yale turned it over in their first possession. Here's McLeod.
Now, see, that's what I'm talking about in terms of defensively tackling a running back like McLeod. You've got to get people on him. Some people pulling on the football once you wrap him up, though, but you better wrap him up, and particularly his legs. If not, you know, he's going to be running all over this field.
It shows you the benefit of these weight training programs, because it shows his upper body strength, and it really, it pays off.
It sure does.
Even though I hated doing it.
You know, coming into the game, Yale had the number one rushing offense in the Ivy League, averaging 207 yards per game. And Harvard had the number one rushing defense. Well, offense is beating defense today. Here's Palimas turning the corner and knocked out of bounds at about the 40 by Andrew Berry, the left cornerback.
Yeah, look at a guy named Taylor Craig, the fullback, number 10 on this play. He just comes out and just blows up the guy on the perimeter. Watch this number 10 coming right. That
looks like a
fullback. Looks like a fullback.
Pulling guard. He's 6'1", 250. I don't know how comfortable I am.
He got a sleeper on that.
He's
one.
Wearing my old number.
Oh, is that right?
Well, he's got a 65-pound weight advantage on Daniel Tanner, who he flattened. It is third down, about 4 yards to go. Palimas from the shotgun. Looking near side, throwing near side, finds his favorite receiver, Chandler Henley, for a first down at the 50.
Now, the quick post is the easiest ball to complete because it's the shortest distance. If you run the out patterns, the ball's in the air longer.
It's almost like the receiver's closing back on you.
Right, he's getting closer. It's very hard to defend.
And on third down, Henley has always been Palimas' favorite receiver. The second or third first down on third down today.
Palimas done a nice job of reading the blitz today, too. And that situation there, he got rid of the football.
McLeod the single back. And let's see what he does with it. Gets to the line of scrimmage, and that's about all. Dives ahead for maybe a yard or two. Glenn Doris, the sophomore linebacker from Marietta, Georgia, made the tackle.
That's the one problem when Harvard blitzes is they don't have those linebackers clogging the quick post lanes.
Because once you get past the first level, that is the defensive line, it's wide open to those receivers.
The linebackers are the people who get in the way of the post patterns.
Second down, about 8. Yale leading by 13.
Here's the blitz again.
And McLeod gets to the line of scrimmage and maybe a yard after that. Eric Schultz makes a tackle along with Glenn Doris.
We talked earlier about timing a blitz and making sure you're going in the direction that the football is coming. This was an opportunity there, and you saw Ryan Tully, the captain of this team, number 37, come in on that blitz and really kind of destroyed the play in the backfield.
Tully in his final game, the senior from Norfolk, Massachusetts. So let's see if they throw it Chandler Henley again. He's in the slot to the right, now in motion to the top of the screen. Looking right and throwing it away. Henley, the intended receiver, and Polemus paid for his indiscretions.
Tough throw for a righty going to the left.
Yeah, and I knew Michael Berg was going to show up before this game was over. Number 96, watch him inside and watch him rush the passer.
Actually, from field position point of view, this is great that he was able to get rid of the ball.
Mm-hmm. But that's a big defensive lineman running.
You know, we saw in the highlights from last year him making that diving interception. He might end up playing tight end instead of a linebacker.
That's right. I think he's going to have an opportunity one way or the other to play on Sunday somewhere for somebody.
Tom Manti will punt it away. And it's a good one. Fair catch at the 13-yard line by Alex Bro. So 8 minutes, 10 seconds to go, third quarter. Yale still sitting on top, 20-7.
Our coverage of Yale and Harvard from 2006 continues, and we're pleased to be joined by junior tight end on the 2006 Ivy League champions, Langston Johnson. Langston, how are you?
I'm doing all right. It is starting to get a little crisper, a little more brisk in San Francisco, California. So hopefully we're getting some rain down here, which means snow in Tahoe. So I'm liking the weather change right now.
My first question is the most important one. Why did you make the decision to come to Yale?
I had a couple of scholarships to some Mountain West schools, or maybe they were WAC schools at the time. And, you know, I was really trying to play at the highest level. Was excited that, you know, Yale offered me, and actually Tony Reno is the original wide receivers coach who recruited me. Ironically, he's the head man right now. So, what's up, Mr. Reno? Coach Reno. I think probably the big thing was being able to play Division I football and then also get the street cred of a Yale degree. So my thoughts were, hey, I can play Division I football, obviously still try and make it to the NFL or play in the pros, had a couple of workouts, little drops in the bucket, but pretty much it was that and get a Yale degree. So ironically, it was a film degree, interestingly enough. And now I'm kind of pivoting into different areas. But it's been great. You know, a lot of great friends there. The recruiting trip really stood out to me. I just loved the guy's attitude, you know, especially when I was watching game tape of them. They seemed like they were having a lot of fun. And that was really important to me, is to have really good community and really good brotherhood.
Talking about this 2006 football team, you all had a great season. You started with a loss, were able to rally. Then you lost to Princeton in the final home game of the year, and now you have to play Harvard. What is the mentality of the team going into this game?
I think the mentality was a pretty intense focus during the practice week. So things were really crisp. People were pretty dialed in. We were just really focused on finishing the job that we had started. So we knew the title was still on the line. And so it wasn't just a Yale-Harvard game. It was also like for the title. And we were pretty good at finishing what we started, you know, drills, practice, workouts and whatnot. And so I was feeling pretty confident with the intensity and the focus level. So that was kind of what we were thinking about, was getting the job done and breaking that losing streak and making a big impact. And so, you know, there's only a few opportunities like this, and we felt like this was a great opportunity to really finish what we started.
The offense in 2006 was dynamic. You guys had great players all over the field. Mike McLeod in the backfield, Matt Polhemus at quarterback, Ashley Wright and Chandler Henley, the list goes on. And all of those weapons really complemented each other.
It was pretty interesting looking at the stat lines after the games, I will say. I find it, like I remember a couple of years ago, Ralph Plum, who was a senior when I was a freshman, It was at Brown, and he set the single game. I think it was either catches in a single game or yards in a single game. And while you're in the game, you're not thinking about it. You're just like, oh, great catch, like moving the chains. I think he scored a touchdown, you know, like a long drive. And then afterwards, you're on the bus, and you kind of see, you know, some of the box scores, the updates, and it's like, Ralph Plum set the record. Like, wait, what? It's just so funny how you're in the moment. You're not really thinking about those things. And so the stat lines, especially the rushing stats, what we saw from the game were crazy. It was like 300 yards, 250. And I just was just laughing, like, wow, we really did this off just a simple couple of plays. You know, we were pretty counter heavy, a lot of dives, boots, waggles and whatnot. But yeah, it's not like we were like the 95 Nebraska team with Tommy Frazier and just like running the option down everyone's throat. So that was really interesting, just how we were balanced, and we could, you know, Matty P was really good at getting out in space and making plays out in the field, as well as distributing, because he was really, really good when he was like on his feet and not just sitting in the pocket. So it was a really exciting team to be a part of. That year was definitely something to remember. And just how we kind of came together and found different ways to win games.
One of the unique things about being a Yale football player is that the two most important games of the year are the last two. How hard is it to prepare for the end of the season when these two games are so important?
That's a good question. I think what also compounds that is that we don't get any bye weeks. So it's just 10 straight games, no bye weeks, just rallying off next. So you don't really get a break. I mean, I guess you could say we're a little, bottom and top heavy, because we don't start the season until mid-September, I think the third week of the regular college football season. So you could say, oh, we had extra rest, and we had extra time, to blah, blah, blah. But I think, yeah, it's really interesting. The last two games are usually the toughest. I mean, actually, during those times, Brown was pretty, they were a pretty tough opponent as well. So it's kind of like the last three. I mean, you could say, well, thankfully we weren't in Ithaca, New York in the middle of winter, November. So I guess that was a positive. Same thing with Dartmouth as well. But yeah, it really dials you in. The good thing is that you can build up to it. So you're not, you know, hitting the panic button after like game one, right? Ironically for our season that year, but you're able to kind of build up and get like in a really good groove. So you're peaking at the right time of the year.
That was Langston Johnson tied in this 2006 Yale Harvard football game. The Bulldogs and the Crimson continue now.
And then of course it was the offensive lineman's fault.
There you go.
On third and 15, here's Pizzotti. In trouble, and down he goes. Bobby Hebert with his first sack of the season. Coming into the game, Harvard led the Ivy League with 44 sacks. Today they have none. And for Yale, this is their fourth sack of the afternoon against Harvard quarterbacks.
Bobby Hebert wasn't even blocked. There was an attempt to block him. But he was never really blocked. It just got in on the quarterback right now.
It's hard
and
to
threw
believe
it to the ground.
Leading the team in tackles, this is his first sack for the season.
Matt Schindel to punt it away. Low snap and almost blocked. Lucky to get it away, but a poor punt that drops dead at the 49 of the Crimson.
They have been close all day today. Yale has them in that punt block team.
So Bobby Hebert with the sack. Everything is looking good for Yale with 4.5 minutes to play in the third quarter.
You can make it if you try.
Obviously, there is a little bit more on the line, but and we'd love to come out of this with an Ivy League championship. But I'd be
willing to bet that our seniors would say it's just as important to beat Harvard as to win that Ivy League championship. They want to have a win over Harvard, and we don't need any added incentives.
It's 20-7 Yale with 4.5 minutes to go in the third quarter. Toward the end of the first half down in Princeton, Princeton has a 17-3 lead over Dartmouth, so it's entirely in the hands of Jackside Lucky's club. At this point, if they want a portion of the Ivy League championship. Long throw over the middle and complete intended for Chandler Henley, and Candace Kruger has an update.
Well, guys, just a hush over the Harvard sidelines, as you can see behind me, after that last possession. And, you know, just very quiet down here. The coaches have been talking to the players about how they've got to stay focused and make the plays that come to them.
And, Dan, this is your alma mater. They don't appear to be focused and haven't appeared to be focused most of the day.
No, and that's been the, you know, that's been the problem, I think, all day long. Is it just hasn't, you don't see that same energy out of them that you've seen in past years in this game, in this bigger game.
Harvard, of course, has won the last 5 years in a row. McLeod gets to the line of scrimmage, 3rd and 10. Time running out on the first half down in New Jersey.
And Princeton in front 17-3. Again, we've talked about the implications of if they win, they have a championship.
We're at Harvard Stadium, built in 1903. On this gorgeous Saturday afternoon, sun is just slowly beginning to set. Temperature naturally beginning to cool off. Polemus looking to heat it up. And what a catch by Chandler Henley. And he's got himself another first down.
And what a pass by Polemus. My goodness, pressure coming right up the gut of the offense. He launches this one, a great pass and a great catch. Nice combination. I tell you what, Brian, this you know, it kind of looks like your combination back in 68, 69. What do you think?
He's got a good arm, no question about that. Picks up the first down by just about a yard.
And Henley with great hands. 5 catches, 3 of them for first downs today. Here's McLeod. On second effort, picks up about 5-6 yards.
That's, you know, what I was talking about, bad tackling, poor tackling.
We'll, you know, get, he doesn't go, he doesn't go, the first hit, he never goes down.
Mm-hmm. And that's where you need the rest of those guys swarming on the onto the football.
McLeod rushed for 91 yards last year against Harvard in his first of these the games. And how about a big afternoon so far in his second effort against the Crimson. Second about 4 yards to go. From the eye, Polemus is in trouble. Throws off his back foot. Pass is complete to Dave Miller, the second string tight end, but there is a yellow flag at the 30-yard line. False start against Yale, so that negates the pickup.
Defense must have been jumping and pulled them off, right?
Dan Jiggetts, big offensive tackle for Harvard, class of 76. Brian Dowling, class of 69 from Yale.
There was an article in the New York Times yesterday about, you know, the Ivy League and the whole idea about where it's gone. Over the last, particularly since 81 when they decided to go 1AA, and how much that has changed the face of Ivy football. To me, you come back and you know, you watch the games now and the players you see coming on the field now, they're bigger.
Illegal
than
formation
we ever were back in that time.
On the offense, only 6 men lined up on the line. 5-yard penalty, repeat second down.
That's normally something that is blamed on the receivers. They blame the offensive lineman, but it's actually on the receivers.
But they don't change their position.
That's exactly it.
Offensive linemen at 300 and some odd pounds are hard to hide.
Hard to hide, yeah. Exactly.
But, you know, the physical stature of the players has changed and improved so much. The strength and conditioning programs are full-time now with 2 and 3 coaches in those areas. So it's a lot more to this game in the Ivy League now than there was ever before.
Referee today is Steve Mataranti, and he is apparently there's some issue with the scoreboard clock. Both coaches are being so informed.
Got an issue with it too. It's moving just a little bit too quickly.
Especially from the Harvard perspective.
That's exactly right. Trying to get a couple more scores. Sorry about that, Brian.
And another official time here. We were looking at Tim Murphy just a moment ago. When you look at stats about coaches and where they rank in some historical perspective, the thing about Tim Murphy at the age of 49 in his 13th year at Harvard, every four-year player he has recruited has either or both graduated and been part of an Ivy League championship team. Talk about a perfect resume.
That's right. It's a full program, and that's the thing that I think has been a hallmark of Tim since he's been here, is a discipline on the football team. And if there's a lack of discipline, you pay the price. We've seen that happen already in some of the situations we talk about, graduating the young men on time, and that's exactly what's been happening. So those are the things you look for, and whether or not, you know, you talk about if you have a successful program. To me, a successful program is if you produce a fine young men and they graduate from the university. That's what it's all about.
He's second on Harvard's all-time win list. Joe Restick with 117. Murphy has 80 against 48 losses and has won 8 of the previous 12 games he has coached against Yale.
And by the way, when we talk about Joe Resick, it's hard not to talk about Carm Kozo, who's here as well. And Carm Kozo, I had a chance to talk with him this morning, and he was talking about the passing of his good friend Bo Schembechler. And they started out playing college
They were
football
teammates together, right? Weren't they?
Miami of Ohio.
Mm-hmm.
And went to
cradle of coaches.
Yeah.
Paul Brown.
Woody Hayes.
There was, you know, as a matter of fact, there have been so many coaches that have come through there, it's almost frightening. Randy Walker, who passed away earlier this year at Northwestern. Walker's doing a heck of a job with the Wildcats.
Well, we're still having clock issues here.
Hey. It's Harvard, Yale. You figure somebody should get a clock right. Huh?
Well, historically, Yale has fared pretty well. And,
well, we talked about the national championships that Harvard got in the 1890s through 1919. It's interesting that in the first 30 games, Yale won 25.
Well, hold on here. Let's
see. Prior
to
the foul, it was second down and 4. We had to reset the box, then enforce a 5-yard penalty. It is second and 9. Please reset the game clock to 2 minutes. 27 seconds, 2:27.
Well, we've wasted the last 10 minutes to save us 7 seconds.
Where was that referee in 1968 about resetting the clock when the clock didn't start on the onside kick?
He may have still been inside his mama.
That's right.
All right, now the clock is running, and here we go. It's second down at about 9 yards to go, and here's Palimas. He's in trouble. And that's the first sack of the day for the Ivy League leading team in sacks. That's Dan Tanner with the sack.
And he looks like a good private detective on this one, doesn't
that's
he?
That's right. Yeah.
Searching that quarterback down. Nice play there. But that was a case where he thought not to throw the football because obviously you had a trap situation. Don't try to throw that ball and throw it up for grabs.
Fortunately, he was able to hold on to the ball, getting blitzed by the blindside by a defensive back.
Well, Dartmouth has scored yet another touchdown in the first half. Princeton now 17 and Dartmouth 10. They have reached halftime. Palimas' throw is complete to Ashley Wright.
I want you guys to watch what Michael Berg did on this play, okay? This is an example of all-out athletic ability. He was started over on the left-hand side of the defense, bounced all the way to right defensive end, and then came in, got cut on the play on the screen, jumps up and goes out and makes the stop. Unbelievable stuff here. This kid is a heck of a football player.
That reception, Ashley Wright, he's now got 24 straight games of at least one reception.
Tom Manti will punt it away. And the fair catch down at the 10-yard line by Alex Crowe. 47 seconds to go, third quarter. Yale leads by 13.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
Welcome back. Harvard trailing Yale 20-7 in the game, 123rd meeting. We talked about Michael Berg before we went to the timeout, and I was saying how much of an athlete he is. And watch him here. He's over on the left side of the defense. He's bouncing down the line, comes in, gets cut right here, gets back up, and makes the play on the outside against the wide receiver. That, my friends, is getting after people and being an athlete on the football field.
And Murphy thinks he has the ability to play at the next level, that is to say, on Sundays in the NFL, probably as a
outside linebacker.
Yeah.
Maybe an inside linebacker.
Pizzotti's throw is incomplete, intended for Jason Miller at second down.
Okay, if we follow the script of the last 4 years or so.
Do we have to do that?
Yes, we do. Let's say a long drive by Harvard to pull to within 6 points.
Hey, Milt Hull is in Hawaii, and he's not coming back.
I was going to ask about that.
For 90
yards. 95 yards.
That's right.
And that kind of would mirror what we've been seeing in the past over the past 4 years.
On second and 10, Dawson gets nothing. But the difference, and we were talking about it during the break, Dan, the difference between this Harvard team and the three that we have covered together, the four of us now, over the past 4 years, they simply have been nowhere near as crisp as they were in the previous three games.
Yeah, and it's one thing, the crispness and the attacking style. Defensively, it seems like they've gotten back on beam, but offensively, it's just been lacking.
Third down and 10. Pizzotti in trouble, and is it a safety or he's down at the one? I guess they'll probably mark it at the two, and that's the way it's been going for Harvard all day long. So, Yale is 15 minutes away from their first Ivy League championship since 1999. Yale is now one quarter away from their first win after five consecutive losses to Harvard in the game. And while time of possession is about the same, every other statistic seems to side with the Yale Bulldogs. Matt Schindel will punt it away. Chandler Henley standing at the Harvard 35-yard line. And a flag flies. Before we can get the first play of the fourth quarter underway, Charlie Steiner, Dan Jiggins, Brian Dowling, Candace Kruger.
False start on the offense, number 22. Half the distance to the goal.
Is that a makeup
repeat
call
fourth down.
For Pizzotti getting sacked on the one and then spotting the ball on the three, and now they move it back to the 1.5?
Again, it's an area thing. Okay. Somewhere in the area.
Close enough.
Area or zip code?
Yeah.
you want to be that flexible, do you?
I mean, Harvard has just come out flat and played flat all day.
Oh, boy. Is it on the end zone? Ooh, 7-yard line?
When you're a yard away from the end of the goal line, or the end zone, and then you punt it 8 yards.
Would you have been better off taking the safety?
That would have made it 22-17. Yeah.
You'd have been better off taking the safety and then,
right,
especially if,
I mean, hindsight.
If, but, yeah, if they score here.
Particularly after a 6-yard punt.
Mm-hmm. And, they, you know, we were talking about how close they'd been earlier in the game. And this time the pressure was severe.
Here's McLeod, who has 2 touchdowns today. Make it 3. 26-7. McLeod's 20th touchdown of the year. And it's a dog day afternoon for the Bulldogs from Yale.
Well, if you're on this Harvard sideline, you hope the one thing happens is that the guys who are remaining get an opportunity to see something like this and never want to have that experience again.
And if you're on the Harvard side, you hope the sun sets real soon.
I was going to say before the bad punt that we may see O'Hagan again, because Pizzotti doesn't seem to move in the pocket as well as O'Hagan.
And so the Bulldogs now have themselves a 20-point cushion with 14:39 left to play.
I can make people miss a lot. I'm obviously not the biggest guy and not the fastest guy in the world, but my vision, I have pretty good vision, and I see the holes and I see what I have to do, and cutbacks, everything. I'm pretty good on my feet, and I don't know, I feel I'm a pretty good all-around back.
Mike McLeod, the scout, that's reporting on the ability of Mike McLeod, the running back.
That's a very accurate assessment of his ability.
He's not bad.
He sees the holes, he's got the quickness to get through them, and he's got the strength to shake off that first tackle.
Both he and Dawson, the thing I like about both of them is that they accelerate when they get to the line of scrimmage. They can accelerate through.
North and south.
Mm-hmm.
5'11", 200-pound sophomore, and he's been the story of the day. And Sherlock goes down at the 22. I mean, nothing is going right for Harvard. And everything is coming up roses, if you will, for the Yale defense this day.
And one of the things, one of the reasons why, is because of Yale's defense been outstanding today, and it's virtually like they've been reading the Harvard playbook before every snap. A lot of pressure on the quarterbacks today. Liam O'Hagan had his problems and issues with pressure. And then Pizzotti comes in and he gets thrown to the ground. They almost get a safety with him.
Well, Pizzotti now has to throw, and the pass is complete at the 29-yard line to Corey Mazza. He picked up about 5 or 6 on the play.
I'll be honest with you, this time around, Brian, looks like all is lost. I don't know. You know, I've never had this feeling before.
This is a key drive. They can score here. They can get back in the game with, you know, 12 minutes to go. They're down 13. That's still we still got a ball game.
I was wondering what you were going to say. I was just baiting you a little bit.
Well, now, if I were the quarterback at Yale, I wouldn't sit on a 20-point lead.
No, not at all.
Keep going for scores.
97 is Jared Hamilton, junior from Alpine, Utah. And he's being helped off the field.
He's had a busy day today as well.
And number 11, Matt Palemas, has had a great day, and he's favorite ride receiver, especially on third down. Chandler Henley has had an outstanding day. And Yale leads by 20. Pizzotti on sideline and well over the head and out of bounds. Corey Mazza is the intended receiver. Candace Krueger has an update from the field. Candace?
Well, Charlie, Corey Mazza had a big scare during preseason last year when he was hit by a car. He was riding his bike when his wheels locked up. He told me he looked down to see if there was something wrong with the chain, and he saw a license plate driving up underneath him. The impact was so fierce that it literally knocked him out of his shoes. Thankfully, though, Corey only walked away with a concussion and some scrapes and bruises, but his confidence riding a bike is still bruised. In fact, he ended up getting a car, so now he gets around campus on four wheels instead of two.
Clifton Dawson.
So he eschewed the training wheels.
Ah, there you go.
Hey, we're at Cambridge. I can use the word eschewed in a football broadcast.
You know, speaking of which, from our perch up here, it's really fun to look out, and you can see, of course, Harvard University, MIT. You go a little bit further over, you can see Boston University. And then on the side of the box, you can see Boston College up in Chestnut Hill. And it's just a beautiful setting up here in Boston. No wonder that, you know, so many kids want to come up here to go to college.
But can you see Harvard beating Yale this afternoon?
Yes. You have to be a man with vision.
Fumble. Harvard's giving it away, and Yale is going to run it away. Steve Santoro and a touchdown.
Steven Santoro, touchdown, Yale.
Is it that vision thing, Dan?
I think you spoke about 5 seconds or 2 seconds too quickly.
I had vision, but unfortunately it was clouded.
This game reminds me a little bit of 1979. Yale was undefeated. Harvard came down in New Haven with a 2-7, and Yale was completely flat, and Harvard upset them. It's sort of like today.
Mm-hmm. And you have Clifton Dawson, who's a guy who never fumbles.
Almost never.
Yeah. It has turned into a rout. Santoro with the fumble recovery and the touchdown.
It's hard to see the ball on that fumble.
And Kimball with the extra point.
Dawson fighting for extra yardage right at the end. The ball comes out.
The ball just... Yeah.
They're looking around for it. Santoro didn't even see it until they...
Well, thank you
very
much.
Nobody knew where the ball was.
That's a strange play. All right, don't ask me any more questions, okay?
Calling the dogs, extinguish the fire. This hunt's about over.
Ladies and gentlemen, if there's a justice of the peace on the ground, would you please report to Section 25?
Steve Santoro.
Yeah. Thank you.
From Fairmont, New York. Sophomore. One of the questions coming into the game today, could Harvard with the experienced quarterback with Mazza, the wide receiver, could they exploit that young secondary? Yeah.
And
Bryce, Hebert, Santoro, and Gerald, three sophomores and a freshman.
Indeed, and yes, they have been able to do that. And it's great to see my old coach here, Coach Joe Restick, looking healthy and fit as always. He was called the Razor when he was playing in the National Football League with Philadelphia Eagles.
Neil Sherlock from the five. Across the 30 and brought down at about the 32-yard line.
Neil Sherlock fielded that kick and returned it to the 32-yard line.
We talked earlier about what you will ask out of your program, and I look back on this young man standing behind me, my coach from my days at Harvard, and you understand exactly what a coach is all about, a guy that helps you become a man, teaches you what it's all about, and puts you on your way, and he certainly did that for me, and I'll never forget it.
Joe Restick, the all-time winningest coach here at Harvard. And Pizzotti gives to Dawson, and he's got some running room. Clifton is tripped up at the 43-yard line by Casey Gerald.
He was tripped up by Casey Gerald.
You know, we were talking with Tim Murphy about one thing, and that is the rules changes in college football and how that has affected, number one, the numbers in games, but also the length of games. And he figures there's about 16 fewer plays in each ball game because of the clock movement now.
About 10% fewer. The throw is incomplete, intended for Mazza. And one of the things we were having this discussion with Tim Murphy yesterday, he said, you know, now again, when we look at statistics and records, and with 10% fewer plays, therefore 10% fewer yards, we may not see the kinds of records that have been broken over the years that much anymore.
Also, long comebacks are going to be a lot tougher because the clock, you don't get that benefit of the clock stopping every first down.
Thanks for that cheerful note.
He's been taking nothing but guff from you, Jiggins, for about 5 years. It's coming out now. Yeah. It's healthy. It's cathartic.
That's exactly right. Yeah, it's been a day of payback, no question about that.
And a night. And a year.
That's it. You have to wait that whole time to get another shot.
Well, again, the way Yale lost it last year, having that big first half lead and then in triple overtime, three successive turnovers. Pass is complete to Farbatko, the tight end, to the 46-yard line. Very close to a first down.
Number 91, Matt Farbatko.
Clifton Dawson, who has averaged more than 100 yards per game this year, has really been stymied, averaging slightly more than 2 yards per carry. What a great credit it is to the Yale defense and their defensive coordinator, Rick Flanders, in his 10th year in New Haven.
But, you know, you go back to the thing that we talked about before with Harvard's offensive line and missing both of those starting tackles. That takes a lot out of your offense because you're talking about the whole from the guards all the way out to the perimeter. It affects all of that in your run game when you miss those big guys.
Plus, the other thing, it shows how much emotion plays in.
First down, Harvard.
In the actual competition on the field, where a team could be down all year, and for one game, they just, you know, they want it.
Come back and bite you.
Well, let me ask you two big football players about that. Everybody knew coming in that Yale, all they had to do was win the game to gain a portion of their first Ivy League title for the first time since 1999. Harvard not only had to win today, but also hope that Princeton would lose to an outmatched Dartmouth team, and it's only a 7-point game down there in New Jersey at the moment. And just in terms of fire and intensity, as Pizzotti throws over the middle, and it's incomplete, intended for Luft, and that was a catchable ball. These are the things that we're seeing all day from Harvard. They just don't look crisp.
You know, and an example of what happens sometimes.
And we have two fans on the field who... In the name of Mike Curtis, is he when we need him?
I'm waiting for Mike Curtis Mike Ditka to come out of the stands.
Yeah.
But what happened to us our sophomore years, we went down to Yale, and all we had to do was win that game for the championship. Yale was out of it, and we kind of went to sleep with a switch and got beat 35-0, which just goes to show you how much and how quickly things can change in this game.
Pizzotti throwing, and it's complete. Oh, Neil Sherlock gets a pounding at the 26-yard line, but a first down.
Plus, Charlie, I don't think the Princeton game is on in these kids' heads. You know, they're worried about their opponent on the field. You know, what happens down in Princeton happens, and they don't have any control over that. But it's really right here.
But Yale really had control of their own destiny today. Harvard comes into the game. Yeah, we have to win and also hope. And I think maybe that X factor. And again, when somebody's punching you in the nose, an offensive line throw toward the end zone. And oh, what a catch! And it's a touchdown to Corey Mazza.
Corey Mazza at 6'3", he used all of his height to catch this one.
So you eliminate that fumble for a touchdown, and it's still a football game.
Eighth touchdown of the year from Mazza, the senior from Thousand Oaks, California, and Pizzotti with the touchdown pass.
Here's a good example, too, of throwing it on the sort of on the opposite shoulder, make it almost impossible for the defender.
The only guy that's going to catch is the receiver.
And he makes a turn inside, and a great play by Mazza.
He knew he just rolled an ace right there.
Well, trailing 34-13, Tim Murphy elects to go for two. 11 minutes, 7 seconds to go. Here's Pizzotti, throwing, nope. So it's a 21-point lead for Yale. Pizzotti with the touchdown pass, his sixth of the year, but Yale continues to sit pretty with a little more than 11 minutes to go in the 123rd game of this rivalry.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
Welcome back. Harvard trailing Yale, and this one 34-13. And we just got on the board here for Harvard. And this is Pizzotti with a long pass to the end zone to Corey Mazin. Corey turned around and got some help. The defense was hoping to get some help from the safety in the middle of the field, Brian, but it got there too late.
Well, I think the pass was a corner pass, but he threw it on his inside shoulder, which was perfect.
And the
going for two, though, was a little strange, unless they figure they're going to make three touchdowns, three 2-point extra points, and then only be a field goal short.
Well, either way, they're still just 21 down. They've gotten to within 19. Steve Santoro's already got a touchdown in his hip pocket today. Retreats into the end zone, and that's going to be a touchback. And Yale will take over. First and 10 at their own 20-yard line. And now you can expect to see a lot of Mike McLeod.
Yeah, because you're going to try to burn as much clock as you can on each drive. I also expect to see some defenders trying to strip that football.
Well, desperation times now for the Crimson, and Jackside Lecky looking for his first win against Yale.
Or against Harvard.
Or against Harvard, yeah. 3-6 against Harvard. In his career, this is his 10th year at Yale for the 55-year-old Side Lecky. And, the alums in New Haven have been huffing and puffing in frustration with Yale's inability to beat Harvard in the game. Well, here's McLeod, and McLeod on second effort picks up 5 yards. That's one constant we've seen all day. Mm-hmm. Whenever the Harvard guys put their arms around McLeod, it takes a second effort before he goes down. Had a great afternoon.
Speaking of great afternoons and great players, I ran into one of my old Bear teammates here. Another one of you Yaleys, that's Gary Fensick, was here with his daughter. And it was good to see him. I haven't seen him in at least a couple of months.
Looks like he could still play, too.
Right? Yeah, he does. He takes great care of himself.
Second down and 5. Here's McLeod again, and this time gets nothing. You and I were talking yesterday, Dan, about inevitably, when you've got two running backs, and one is the big headline maker in the case of Clifton Dawson, it's the other guy who somehow feeds off all that attention. Mm-hmm. And today, McLeod has had the better of the play of the senior running back from Harvard.
Yeah, he really has. And I mean, he's had some punishing yards, too, because he's been running through defenders. If you like offense, then you like seeing something like that.
And McLeod is the leading rusher this year in the Ivy League. And, of course, Dawson is the leading running back in the history of the Ivy League. And here's McLeod at second effort again, but he falls about a yard or two short of the first down.
Something that I've learned from watching the defense of the Chicago Bears, Lovey Smith's defense, is that if you have guys, number one, quick guys shooting gaps, you've got to have guys then who stay concentrating on staying in those gaps, number one, are disciplined enough to do that. Number two, pursuit to the football. If you don't get everyone pursuing to the football and all 11 trying to get in on the tackle, you've got problems if a guy spins away and out of a tackle. And that's what we've seen a little bit of today.
Andrew Berry and Stephen Williams standing back at about their own 40-yard line, awaiting the punt from Tom Manti, who's averaged about 37 yards per punt today. Fourth down and 1. High, decent punt, fair catch at the 43 made by Stephen Williams.
I wonder if this could ever come down to, in this game, come down to a factor. And you notice when you're punting out of that end zone, the wind up top of the stadium, when that ball gets to the top, gets pushed back. And you can see the Harvard and Yale flags at the open end of the stadium. Both of them are coming back in that direction.
Well, he's kicking into the wind.
Yeah, very much so.
Way up on top of the stadium, but the flags on top of the goalposts aren't even moving.
Aren't even moving.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Dawson across the 45 to the 46. Candace Krueger's got an update from the field.
Well, Charlie, one thing that these teams share is a real passion for the game of football. That passion is evident in the fact that there are no athletic scholarships given out at either of these two schools. The commitment that these guys make to be a part of these programs is truly unbelievable. You can bet they really love this game.
Second and seven. Pizzotti, long throws, sideline. Nearly caught by Matt Luff, despite double coverage.
And he made a great attempt to catch that one.
Santoro and Rice.
Rice is looking at it like he's got it all the way, and Luff reaches over his shoulder, almost catches it.
That's a really
great effort.
That size becomes a real valuable tool.
Well, time is of the essence for Harvard, trailing by three touchdowns and three extra points. So Pizzotti's got to throw for it, and it's incomplete. For Botko, even if he had made the catch, would have been short by about 3 yards of a first down.
Yeah, get beyond the sticks. I mean, that's what you've got to do. You've got to get the first down at least.
But
key play here. They've got to hold on to it because they need three scores, but they don't make it. Yale's going to have great field position.
Well, let's get the sense of 7.5 minutes to go. This is Harvard's last stand. Pizzotti steps up, throws, incomplete. Baza, the intended receiver. Yale takes over on downs. They've got 7.5 minutes to kill.
You think on a play, fourth down like that, that they delay somebody out of the backfield, just jump it, because they only needed 5 yards.
Right, and then the problem that they had, though, was on the offensive line. We had the center and the left guard get beat, and that put immediate pressure.
But those delays out of the back are almost like a delayed screen, middle screen.
Right, because the pressure comes past you, and then
you just dump it over their heads.
Well, Coach Tim Murphy has not tasted defeat against Yale in a very long time. A five-game winning streak appears to be coming to an end. McLeod gains a couple. About a 70-yard disparity in rushing.
It says a lot about where Tim Murphy has brought this program here at Harvard, that in a year when you go maybe 7-3, it's looked upon as a down year. In a year of adjustment. And you look back on all the undefeated teams that he's had in the championship teams, and he has done a wonderful job.
And Jack Sidlecki for his first Ivy League title since 99. Palimas run out of bounds by Dan Tanner, short of the first down. That's one of those where he probably would have been better served just to slide and keep the clock running.
Keep it rolling.
Third and one to go.
Third down and one. Well, as the sun begins to set, it is getting a bit cooler.
Where's your sweater, Charlie? You want to tell the story about your sweater?
No. No, I don't. Third and one. McLeod has a first down. Well, I suppose with a 21-point game. And
there you go.
And 6 minutes and change to go.
Now, you went and bought the sweater.
I went, yesterday before Mr. Jiggets and I went over, came over here to Cambridge in the first down. Looked at the old weather forecast. Hey, it's going to be chilly. Ooh. Hey, this just in. It's fall in New England. So I said, I need a sweater. So we went to Macy's. And I've come to the conclusion now, in every shopping mall in America, there is a Macy's, there is a Starbucks, and there's a Wilson, Williams and Sonoma. I didn't need a pot or a pan.
Or a cup of coffee.
Or a cup. Well, I did.
We did need the coffee. That's right.
That's multitasking. That's right. There, Brian. I got coffee and went shopping for a sweater. So I found a nice sweater.
beautiful sweater.
A very nice sweater. As I unpacked it this morning, getting ready for the game, there's this thing on my sweater.
That thingamabob.
How'd you get out of the store?
I don't, one of those security things where if you open it up, it's like,
yeah, there it is.
See that? There it is.
He's still got the thingamabob on it.
Yeah, so, you need a tool that's made the in,
I can't wait to go through the airport tonight with that puppy.
Then they look at you like you're Winona.
We're going to take a break. We're going to regroup and see if we can get this thing off my sweater in the meantime. It's 34-13, 5 minutes, 9 seconds to go, and Yale's on its way to at least a share of the Ivy League championship. Yale leads 34-13, a little more than 5 minutes to go in the game. The tail of the tape between the two great running backs. Well, on this day, Mike McLeod, the sophomore from New Britain, Connecticut, has outrushed the all-time leading Ivy League running back, Clifton Dawson, by a fair amount. 3 touchdowns. McLeod is unbelievable in that he has scored by far the most, not only the most touchdowns on this Yale football team, but he has scored 20 of their 31 touchdowns this year. And here's McLeod again, and he's getting busy. This is the time now when the defensive line really absorbs a beating.
That's it, because you know that they're not trying to throw the football. They're not trying to fool you into thinking they're going to throw the football. They just want to line up and lean on you a little bit as an offensive line, and that's what's happening now with the Harvard defensive front.
And the team with the big lead, they're pushing forward. They feel like it's their game. And
grinding the clock, letting it roll.
And in this case, it is better to give than it is to receive on third down. And about 7. There's McLeod again. And he picks up a couple.
And we got a flag on the play as well. Something extra at the end, I think.
Now the inevitable frustration appears to be kicking in too. That's Brad Bagdus, 81. Bagdus, a junior from Paxton, Massachusetts, and it's been a long time since Tim Murphy's team has absorbed a beating like this one.
After the play, personal foul. On the defense, number 37, unnecessary roughness, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
That's Ryan Tully, the captain.
Sort of puts an exclamation point on the afternoon.
Certain amount of frustration, I'm sure, but you can't let that get the best of you because you're putting yourself and your team in a really tough spot. Let's see what he did. He's in on the stop.
37.
Yeah, I didn't see anything illegal. Yeah.
Illegal, untoward, or otherwise. Well, as we've mentioned really throughout the game, Harvard just simply came out flat today. Mm-hmm. And Yale a little uncertain of themselves early in the game. And a pickup of 5 more. This Taylor Craig, the big fullback.
Certain challenges you want to meet even when a game is out of hand like this one is for Harvard. Especially if you're a senior, this is an opportunity to stop the offense right here, make them kick a field goal. Just small victories within the greater perspective of the loss that you're absorbing today.
Well, that's where, human instinct just kind of takes over. You know you're trailing by 21. Mm-hmm. You know you want to win those battles. But at the end of the day, I guess that's the difference between the really elite athletes and guys. You know, try to create that competition for yourself as the interior of the Harvard line does just that now.
You don't want to cheat yourself, because the problem is not so much what happens today. It's what happens for the rest of your time playing or the rest of your life. You don't want to pick up that tape, put it in the old receiver or deck, and all of a sudden find out that you didn't do your job. Looks like Jack Ziglecki is about to get Gatorade doused.
Yep. Fran Hollander.
Guys sneaking behind the bench, getting the bucket.
I wonder what vintage that is.
June.
Yeah. Oh, they've got ice right on the ball. Nice.
McLeod brought down behind the line of scrimmage.
He never broke stride.
No smile.
Look at that. Come on, Jack. There it is. He's reluctantly smiling. Oh, how cold is that?
And you got a man up there. You don't want to turn around and ask for a jacket or something like that.
Jim Burt started the terrible tradition of the Gatorade stuff with Bill Parcells when they were with the Giants.
It looks like we got a player kicked out of the game.
After the play, we have offsetting personal fouls. Number 62 in the defense, number 77 in the offense. Fourth down.
Matt Curtis is 62 on the defense. Nick Wachler, the center, on the offense. And that's Steve Williams, who is on the Harvard sideline now, talking with Tim Murphy.
Well, they didn't get ejected, but
no.
Williams came out. Looked like he was thrown out the way he was walking off the field.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there was something going on there.
He points him off the field, so maybe he did kick him out.
He wasn't penalized. He was merely thrown out.
Yeah. Shown the door.
Your assignment, should you decide to accept it, is to leave the field. Mission not accomplished, not impossible.
Certainly not on this day. They have come to the end of the third quarter in New Jersey, and Dartmouth has pulled all even with Princeton. So there's a chance that Yale can win outright the Ivy League championship. The Budweiser player of the game, that's Mike McLeod. Budweiser, bright, crisp, clean, pure, and what a day he has had. Three touchdowns, Ivy League's leading rusher this year. 87 yards, 34 carries.
And
he still has two more years.
Yeah, and you have to love the way he runs the football. I mean, that's all-out aggressiveness, attacking the defense, and never stopping his feet from moving.
Well, you see the Yale fans reacting. They just heard the Dartmouth-Princeton score.
And so Mike McLeod, Budweiser's player of the game. This is Budweiser. This is beer. And this is a beating. Administered by Yale over Harvard. And this is the 123rd playing of
I guess
the
you
game.
Could consider a field goal here, but, you know, doesn't really help you that much.
That
and if it's
just
blocked,
cruel,
and it could be run back for a quick score, I guess he's deciding to just go for it. Just run the clock down some more.
Well, it'll be first down for Harvard with a minute and 42 seconds left. Well, look for Yale to go to 8-2 and 6-1 in the Ivy League.
Mm-hmm.
And the Yalies are big-time Dartmouth fans at the moment.
It's about the only time they'll be Dartmouth fans.
Chandler Henley, who had a spectacular afternoon catching passes from Matt Palemas. And the senior from Littleton, Colorado, will go out a winner.
And other than the three-point loss last week against Princeton in the last couple of minutes, Yale only lost to University of San Diego, which is still undefeated in 1AA. the first game of the year.
Well, they give to Dawson in his last series as a running back here at Harvard, brought down by Brady Hart, second down.
Let's go!
It may not have ended the way that you know you want to, but Clifton Dawson has been a great running back, obviously for Harvard, and a great representative, I think, of the Ivy League in general.
It's too bad after such a great career, he's got to have such a frustrating last game.
As he comes off the field.
Although you can understand that.
So Dawson comes off the field for the last time as Pizzotti throws over the middle. And he completes it to Neil Sherlock. He gets it out to about the 40-yard line with 37 seconds left in the game. So congratulations to the Yale Bulldogs, who have won at least a portion of the Ivy League championship. And for 55-year-old Jack Sidlecki in his 10th year at Yale, fourth time he has beaten the dreaded Crimson.
And he really needed this win today, didn't
Well,
he?
Not only that, I think it helps him on his contract extension, too.
Always get
oh,
the paper.
That.
Get to the paper, my friend.
Oh, that. And in the fashion that Yale lost last year, at home to Harvard, final game of the year as it is every year, the big 21-3 lead into the third quarter, and then triple overtime where they did nothing. They turned it around and handed it to Tim Murphy's team. The folks in New Haven have reason certainly to be celebrating tonight. Here's Pizzotti with 35 seconds left throwing, and it's incomplete. Intended for Sherlock.
We've got another streaker out here on the field.
And he is a streaker.
He's old school, too.
He's got plenty of nothing. And
he's at the 30. He's at the 35, the 40.
Where's
the
Mike 45. Curtis when you need him?
Let me put it to you this way. Somewhere across this country, there's a mother and father who must be terribly proud.
Oh, nice move there. Security, got him.
Well, there's another one in the end zone who is, chilly.
He's down at the 30.
Those handcuffs have to be cold. On.
It's not the only
You're worried about
cold.
The handcuffs?
Tell you what, there's no better night Smith in jail. No better night Smith in jail.
Always a little excitement at the game.
What was that old song? Nothing from nothing leaves nothing.
Leaves nothing.
And two streakers are the only thing we can guarantee. They're heading to a warmer place. With 29 seconds to go. No ifs, ands, or buts. Pizzotti throws sideline. And it's complete to Farbatko, the tight end.
There's a tagline to that one. I'm just going to leave it alone.
You just wonder if Harvard can come from behind.
I'm laying out.
Not anymore. It's 34-13. 24 seconds to go. All right, enough. That's about what Harvard's thinking, too, at this point. Here's Pizzotti again. Over the middle, tip, and wouldn't you know it, the game ends on an interception. That's the way the day has gone. Larry Hebert, who came into the game not having any interceptions this year, has a pick. He also has himself a sack. And the Yale folks along their sideline could not be any happier.
Well, Brian, congratulations to your guys. They came in and they did it this year. They took it from the top.
They really did. They really got a hand it to them.
That's it. We're done.
Let's hope we convene next year down in New Haven. That we will have a very competitive finish to the ball game.
Well, we had the longest game ever played in Ivy League history, much less the game, and time is now running out. And those two old teammates, roommates, in fact, Jack Sidlecki, Tim Murphy, congratulate one another, and Yale, the winner of the Ivy League, at least a portion of it, with Princeton. Princeton and Dartmouth are tied at 17 in the third quarter in New Jersey. Congratulations to the Bulldogs. We're going to take a break. We still have miles to go before we sleep. And so Yale, a 34-13 winner in the 123rd playing of the game. At long last, Yale's national nightmare is over. They've finally beaten Harvard after the Crimson had beaten them the last five games in a row. Chandler Henley among the happy fellas down there on the field. 34-13, the final. Dan, some final thoughts.
Well, you know what? It was a wonderful effort today by Yale. You know, they knew that they had the championship within sight, and they did everything they possibly could to go out and attack it and win that championship, take that championship. Congratulations to them. And I know Jack Zdlecki and his crew, you know, this was a thing that had been, you know, really eating at them for some time now, and now they're able to not only beat Harvard, but also win the championship. Congratulations to them.
Well, you wonder with Dawson and O'Hagan, the same characters that pulled out the game last year for Harvard, you wonder when they were going to ignite, and they never did.
And in the case of Clifton Dawson, his career ends on a sour note, but he leaves Harvard as the all-time leading running back in the history of the Ivy League. So that's a wrap for us from Harvard Stadium in Cambridge, Massachusetts. For Candace Krueger and Dan Jiggins and Brian Dowling, I'm Charlie Steiner saying goodbye and happy holidays, everybody, as Harvard falls to Yale at home. And congratulations to Jack Zdlecki. It's the Bulldogs 34 and the Crimson 13. Goodbye from Cambridge, Massachusetts.